Plus 2 is proud to bring you the 2 Plus 2 Pokercast, presented by the Pokerstars VIP Club.
This week on the Pokercast, Doug Polk, John Beauprez and Matthew Hilger. Now here they are. One of them is running out of gas on the way to the station and one is running out of gas while fighting a world champion. Adam and Terrence.
Welcome to the 2 Plus 2 Pokercast, presented by the Pokerstars VIP Club. I am your host, Dave Schwartz, alongside, not figuratively, but literally, Mr. T-Chan, who is on his way to Vegas in Seattle, I believe, right?
I think you meant not literally, but figuratively. But yeah, we all got the gist of what you're saying. Yep. Not too far.
You know, I was guessing. It was a coin flip if I was going to get it right or not.
Yeah, and it's generally a coin flip whether I'm going to call you out on things like that. So, you know, you managed to hit a parlay and lose twice. So that's
a parlay and a loss.
Yeah, I'm in Seattle, not as far away as you as I usually am. But yeah, we're en route to this this poker tournament. I don't know if you've heard of this, but there's a poker tournament that's happening throughout June. And, you know, I've decided to attend it this year, as I have, I guess, for the last 13 or whatever years. But yeah, I'm in Seattle. I'm having an awesome time, by the way. Vancouver and Seattle obviously really close together, but I've done some cool stuff on this trip and it's been a super short trip. Got to go in a helicopter for the very first time.
Let's get to that in a sec. Let's introduce our producer Roscoe P. Coltrane. Roscoe,
hi. I'm running the show from an undisclosed location.
Are you at some bunker in Pakistan or something?
Yeah, I'm hiding from the downswing gods.
Oh no.
How's that working out for you?
It's not well. They found me.
Thanks to T for doing the show last week, and Ross, of course, as well. Dan O'Brien, I listened to a good show. Glad you fought through the sickness that was going on. You're cured. You're all good now.
Probably not. You'll probably still hear me like hacking up some phlegm and all that sort of nonsense. But yeah, I'm a little bit better. I actually got real sick the day after that recording. I was just sort of like full blown, and I haven't been sick in forever. I never get sick, and I'm very, very proud of that fact. But yeah, I guess it happens every couple of years, and so it was probably just like some kind of throat infection. So yeah, you know, I'm like 85.5% recovered now. So I was able to train in the gym today and all that. So yeah.
0.855 Terrence will have to do today. That's good. I was off at the Matt Savage Invitational Golf Tournament in Lake Tahoe, his yearly gamblers anonymous meeting, basically,
that's right.
Happens when we all get together and play a bunch of golf and gamble up a storm. It was a lot of fun. Some great folks there. You get to know a lot of people that you know, we've had on the show before, and it's kind of fun. We're all in the same place, play the same golf course, and gamble up pretty hard. These guys play really high, like one round. I don't play anywhere near this. We were playing $100 skins, and then
so you got a name drop. So when you say these guys, you got a name drop. So feel free to start name dropping.
I can't. For the story I'm going to tell, I can't.
Okay. So okay. All right.
So we're
but people that people would know. Like, is it people that people who listen to the show you would know these names?
Yeah, some of them. The main story here that I'm about to tell is. Probably you'd have to be a pretty hardcore poker fan to know the guy who won all the money, but he's been on TV before. But either way, so we're playing, and they wanted to play $100 skins, which means for those that don't golf, every hole, so there's four of us in a group, every hole everybody puts up 100, and the winner gets the 400. If there's a tie, we carry over to the next hole, so it's now 800. And I backed down. These guys were high rollers for me. So I started playing 50s, and they were playing overs. And then it got higher and higher and higher. And eventually, at the end of the round, one of the guys won 20,000.
Wow.
And I was just like spinning my head, like, you know, and it was nothing. It really was.
Is this handicapped at all, or are you guys about the same level? Is that why it's fair?
Okay. It's handicapped to fair, yeah. So
right. So, I mean, potentially – if you, I mean, in theory from the beginning, if you're playing, you know, to make sure I understand this correctly, like if you never win like one of these skins, one of these pools, you'd be down 1,800 if it stayed at $100 a pop,
correct.
Right? But because it's kept getting bigger, then, you know, you could be down more than 1,800.
Yeah. So one guy played really, really well and ended up winning a bunch of the skins. And I ended up with two skins all. So I ended up losing a little bit of money, but we had
It still strikes me as crazy. And I mean, I've been around golf gamblers all my life. And, you know, you're a golf gambler and most like probably 75% of the poker players I know are golf gamblers. It always strikes me as crazy that you have to take somebody's word for how good they are when there's so much money on the line, right? Like if I go golfing with you, that I have to believe you're as good as you say you are. And you have to believe that I'm as good as you say you are, when there's so much incentive to lie and sandbag and just be like, no, sure. I'm a 5 handicap when in reality you're a 2 handicap or whatever it is. Right.
So what happens with that is when the first time, like, let's say you and I went and played and we're going to gamble, the very first time we play, or there for a few times, we don't gamble very high. We're playing for money, whatever, but it's not typically too crazy until you kind of get a feel on how you can kind of tell after playing golf with the guy for one, sure, or two or three or four times how good he is. Even you could, I mean, I could probably just play golf with the guy, not know his handicap, and be within a shot or two of his handicap just by watching him play. Right. You know, without counting up or seeing what he shot or whatever. So you get a handle on people's games pretty much. These guys, a lot of them have been getting together for many years. Matt Savage plays golf with them a lot. He knows sort of – he sets the handicaps pretty fair. So
Matt said – okay. So I would trust Matt, obviously, to be able to do that. Okay.
Well, but he's got to take people's word for it a little bit.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you work out your own matches that you get – let's say all 64 players that were there – get a handicap from Matt based on some discussions with Matt on, you know, what their actual handicap, whatever, how they're playing, etc. But when you get in a group each day, when you get in a group with your guys, you can then negotiate again. It doesn't have to be the handicaps that are made in the Savage tournament. You can say, look, I've played with you a bunch. I know you're this, I'm that. I'll give you two aside and we're fair, and boom, you're off gambling. So
sure.
That's sort of how that works. But so I didn't mean to interrupt your story from Seattle. I was in a helicopter recently. I beat you to it sounds like. And
your first time?
Yeah, Wilson and I, when we went over to have a Big Wheel Burger in Victoria a couple weeks ago, we did the helicopter back and forth.
I'm sure Scott Wilson's been in many, many helicopters over his time, but it was my first time. I you know, a friend of mine who's here in Seattle, you know, connection to poker, he's JC Alvarado's strength coach. You know, and that's how I know him, but he's actually learning. I mean, he's got his helicopter license. He's getting his commercial helicopter license. So that's just about like putting hours in, and he's put a ton of hours in. So I trust him. And he actually even still has his instructor in the cockpit with him. So, you know, if he screws it up, it's not too bad. It wasn't scary at all, but we got some gorgeous views of Seattle. And we just went like an hour in like a circle. We went straight out east. We saw some, you know, we saw all the usual, you know, tourist stuff. You know, there's Snoqualmie Falls, and, you know, that's beautiful, and that's everything, and this and that. But, you know, there's Bill Gates' house, and there's, you know, Russell Wilson's house, and Steve Ballmer's house. And then, but you saw some, I saw some houses that I never would have seen. Like, you could live in a city for 25 years and not know that these houses existed, because they're like on the tops of mountains, completely surrounded by forest. We saw one house that had its own like horse racetrack. Like, I'm not kidding. There's like a lake in the middle. Like, it looks like the Kentucky Derby, you know, thing. And there's like stables. It's like dotted with stables. You know, we're only like 800 feet in the air, but you can see the stables. Like, there's the stable boys probably live in these houses. And you just have no idea that these houses would ever exist. Like, you know, there's rich people. You don't know how many of them there are until you live in a helicopter. So that was a pretty awesome thing.
I had a friend that was from Washington, and he had some wealthy family members, and he said that I think there's a lake in Washington where some of the richest people in all of America have like summer houses and houses around there.
Yes, we definitely saw areas where every house had its own dock. I don't know what the term is, but the place you put your boat. You know, so yeah, I guess it's a dock. But like, there's basically, you know, giant house with like 19 bedrooms, dock and boat, and they're just like dotted like that, the way that, you know, you would see every other house in middle America would have car with a driveway and like a basketball for kids to shoot into. They just had boats instead. It's all the same. It's pretty amazing. And then if that wasn't amazing enough, today I got to train with the world champion in my weight class. I got to actually spar Demetrius Mighty Mouch Johnson, and I mean that was a lot of fun. I mean, I got the hookup to train. You know, JC helped me out with that. He contacted Matt Hume and, you know, all this kind of stuff. So I got to spar with that. So, I'm having a hell of a time.
That's pretty interesting because, you know, you've been on some of the sort of lower tiers from the UFC, the professional ranks, the fights, and, you know, obviously not going to be on the level of the UFC, but now you get to fight against the world champion or spar with the world champion. Do you get a sense of how the gap there, or what how did that go?
It's obviously, you know, I've a little work to do. I didn't manage to easily destroy the reigning world champion at 125 pounds. So, you know, there's a little bit of work left. I've a good sense of.
Yeah, were you shocked at how good he was or anything? Like, did he do anything that you went, holy shit, or like?
No, I mean, I was hoping to do better, I guess. But I also my expectation was to sort of get outclassed, and that's what I was. But, he didn't feel like amazingly strong for his size. You know, he's obviously the same size as me. But he was just technically good, like just slightly better in every single way. I mean, it's just there's that skill level. Like, I think you know how to do the same things, but I mean, it's just a matter of willing your body to be able to do those things, and he's just better at that. So that's all there is. All that stands between me and world champion is just doing the small things better.
Did it motivate you to do different things? Can you see yourself, you know,
so I mean, I'm talking to my girlfriend on the walk home, and I'm like, well, now I'm just super motivated to spend the next 6 weeks in Vegas training instead of playing poker. Right. She says, and I was like, you know, maybe I'll play the main event. No, this is kind of joking, but like, yeah, I mean, I'm super motivated to kind of see, you know, the best in the world at what you do is awesome. I mean, I don't think there's anything more motivating than that. And I was telling all the other guys in the gym, like, you guys are so lucky to be able to train with like a genius coach like Matt Hume and a champion, and they realize they're lucky, and it's pretty cool. So I mean, I've got a bunch of bucket list things checked off all in like what the space of less than 24 hours. I think the helicopter was late last night. So I've had a good trip.
So everybody who picked Terrence Chan in the PokerCast WSOP fantasy pool is drawing stone dead, is what you're saying.
Oh, that's, well, I mean, you're not drawing dead. I mean, the rest of your team could be really good. But I've told people many times they'll pick me. I didn't put myself on my team, on my fantasy team. I finally submitted a team, by the way. I got it snuck in under the line. You did, but I heard yours was over budget, so well done.
Wait a minute. I don't know what happened there, but we'll figure it out.
What was your strategy other than being over budget?
My strategy was to pick my team within like 2 minutes. That's what. Yeah. That's the amount of time I had devoted to it. So I just kind of went him.
You didn't have time to do addition and find out whether you were under the
exactly. Yeah.
Mine was pretty straightforward. I just took the prices from last year's 25K fantasy.
Oh, you value whore. I love it.
Yeah. They didn't get worse.
Those guys didn't get worse at poker.
Exactly. Like, at most, the way I play less. So I just basically put in a spreadsheet and say, points divided by salary, and I say like, okay, who's value? I'm like, all right, well,
oh my god,
guys,
always gotta have an edge.
I can't imagine that I'm the only person who do this. So that's sort of the problem. It's sort of like the daily fantasy sports thing, right? It's like everybody kind of knows who the good picks are, so you kind of have to have a unique one.
So who did you go? Were there some player? Did you just strictly go like the top 10 value picks?
No, not quite. I mean, it's not as easy as that, because you will go over the salary cap fairly quickly if you do that. So I can't remember exactly who's all on my fantasy team, but I did remember some surprising players that rosters are locked now, right? I don't think I'm giving anything away, but there's a bunch of people where I was very surprised cost the $75 minimum.
That was my mistake. I thought it was I did it in like 5 minutes today. I had no time, like I mentioned. I had to get it in under the wire, and I didn't read everything properly. I thought if the player wasn't on the list, that he was $1, but it turns out he's $75. So I went over there. I'm going to have to take one of those.
Can we get a buzzer? Can we get a buzzer, Ross? Can we get a buzzer? That's the incorrect thinking. No, but there are some people who only cost $700. That surprised me. Sean Buchanan was at the top of the list. That really shocked me that he was in for the minimum. Mike Mizrachi, the grinder, was $75. Okay. Mike Matisau also, Adam Friedman. So there are definitely some bargain picks to be found, at least in
my opinion. So saying those, before you get past that, Steve O'Dwyer, Ike Haxton, and the one that I think made everybody's list was Dmitry Urbanovich, the 21-year-old guy who's run up millions of dollars. So these are guys that were all not on the list because, of course, Urbanovich didn't play last year. So he is $75, and I think he's going to be one of the guys on most of the 125 teams we got for
I screwed up. Yeah, I totally forgot because, like I said, like I was just saying, all I did was I cross-referenced my team with last year's list, and I forgot that Urbanovich is on there, and that's such a huge fish play because he's obviously going to be tremendous value at $75.
But because everybody has him, if he blanks off, maybe it's a good thing.
Just like daily fantasy, usage rate matters. So yeah, if he, you know, I'm anti-sweating him, I guess, but at this point. Yeah, you have $75 ones in there as well, as you mentioned.
I know I've got some good players on here, but it doesn't sound like they are the same as everybody, which could be good. But I have to say that I was more weighted. Like, when I saw the list of people, I was more weighted to pick the all-in-or knocked-out black chip contributors.
Oh, yeah.
I got Mr. Paul G's on there, Jeff Rossiter. You know, when it came down to it, I was like, well, these guys helped me out. You know, I'm gonna put them on my team.
That's true. Yeah, we've been getting some black chips. Thank you.
Because what they get from when you pick them, Ross, of course, is PokerCast karma.
Yes. All in a.
It's all in or knocked out karma. Yeah, we haven't determined whether this is a thing yet, but we're going to find out very shortly.
Yeah.
Find out a big.
It's like secondhand PokerCast karma.
Before we get on to some, in case you missed it, just a quick topic, and it's sort of, you know, when I was away at the golf tournament, we heard that the lead singer of a band from Canada called the Tragically Hip was diagnosed with terminal brain cancer, and his name's Gord Downie, and he's a national hero up here in Canada. I know probably rest around the world it's not that big of a deal to everybody, but for Canadians, it's a pretty big blow. Tragically Hip have been a staple in Canadian music for decades. This band sells out football stadiums in Canada regularly, and then they'll go down to the U.S. and you can see them in a club with 200 people or around the world similar. So, you know, it was tough. And, you know, we have music bumpers on this show. So I think what we're going to do this week is have a couple of Hip songs. It's music bumpers. They're playing one last tour across Canada. They don't know if Gord's going to make it. It's kind of scary, but they're starting in Vancouver. Unfortunately, we're on our MJ and I and our buddies are all on our annual golf trip at the end of June. So not going to be able to make the local tours, but thinking about they're from Kingston, Ontario. They're playing their final show in Kingston in August, and a few of us are thinking about flying back to Kingston to see that final gig, and I believe it's going to be televised live on CBC as well. So,
what song are we thinking?
That'll be an emotional one.
Can we do Bob Cajun?
We could definitely do Bob Cajun. Fantastic Hip song. We'll do Bob Cajun. We'll pick another one for the other break. Or my thoughts anyway are with Gordon and his family for the last little while.
Have cancer for sure.
Yeah, have cancer. Let's get to some. In case you missed it.
How did he miss the open goal? 6-4, and he comes up zero.
Oh no! Oh yes, he missed it.
He's missed it. How on earth did he miss that?
In case you missed it, and I doubt that you have, the World Series of Poker kicked off 4 hours ago, I believe, with the casino employees event, the very first of 69 events, always the first one out of the box. That started today at 11. In case you missed, it's going to be a little light this week. Everybody's making their way to Las Vegas. Nothing's really happened yet other than the $300,000 ball, super high roller bowl, which we'll get to, and that isn't even done yet. But the World Series of Poker, everybody is giggity. Everybody's so happy. It's funny, T, when you get to to Vegas the day or two before the World Series starts. Everybody's there. Everybody's still got a ton of money. They're getting anxious about all the schedule, trying to figure out where they're going to play. This year, the Colossus is kicking off the very beginning of the series. This is the $7 million guaranteed prize pool Colossus, $500 buy-in, six flights, and $1 million guaranteed to the winner. That starts tomorrow, runs through Saturday. T, you going to jump into the Colossus?
I won't actually make it down, I think, in time for the Colossus. I'm still in Seattle, and we're not doing the 24-hour marathon drive. So, you know, and it's sort of an excuse to miss the Colossus. I did play it last year, and it is obviously a total zoo. I don't know. Maybe I'll be able to fire the last bullet. But I'm looking forward to the Turbo Top-Up event, which is event number 4, I want to say. I don't think that's correct. But the Turbo Top-Up event, yeah, it is event number 4. And the one that where you have to win a sit and go online and you get a double starting stack. But you know me, I love my turbo tournaments. I love any tournament that kind of goes quickly. The degen that I am, want to gamble it up. But you're right. The energy in that place, always awesome. People approach with sort of this, you know, depending on who you are, you've got the pros coming in and say, all right, well, here's the 7 weeks of grind. Like, here's how it's going to be. And, you know, some people, like you say, come in with a bunch of energy and optimism. But, you know, I think most people, when you walk down that hallway for the first time, you know, in a series, it's a great feeling. You know, it's full of optimism. Maybe this is the year, or if you've had a great year before, it's like, maybe this year will be like that year. And, right. Like you say, everybody's bankroll is still full. Everybody's scraped together their backers and they've got their schedules printed out. And yeah, it's like, I'm excited to go. Like I said, the first one will be the Turbo Top Up. I've got a few more on my list. You know, Dealer's Choice might be fun if I get in there. Well, I know it is fun. The Deuce of Seven Triple Draw coming up soon, and there's a lot of events that look really fun for me this year. So I know I just finished saying, what was it, like 10 minutes ago, that, you know, I'm going to be in the gym a bunch, and, you know, I'm going to train all this jujitsu and kickboxing and all this stuff. But, you know, now that I look at the schedule, I'm like, you know, there's 1500 six max. The small buy-in six maxes are always super fun. And then, you know, like, look at all that's going on. Hey, there's even Raz the next day after that. So maybe I'll shoot up some 1500 seven card Raz and try to tilt people by catching perfect while their ABCD catches queen.
You're going to be Phil Hellmuth this year? That's what you're going to do, your Phil Hellmuth impression?
Well, that's generally what you do when you play a Raz tournament, right? Is just get it in chasing, you know, half board locked, and come up smelling like roses in Raz tournaments, and now you get to tell people you have two Raz bracelets against all odds.
I think
I'm
near full power.
So let me guess. So the Turbo Top Up, you talked about it. If you win a Turbo, is it a single table tournament online? I guess.
I think it's a 50. You have to win a $55 sit and go on WSOP.com get a double starting stack. I think you get a 10K starting stack if you do that.
So the value is huge, obviously, to get that. I can see you rolling into Nevada in the car. You're driving down there. I know your girlfriend is traveling with you, so maybe she gets to drive from the Nevada border down to, and you're going to tether your phone to your laptop, and you're just going to be playing single table tournaments till you get to Vegas?
Spoken like a man who has never driven through the desolate desert of northern Nevada. There is no way that there's a data connection.
That's right.
Like, You know, that's always like the scariest part of the drive, because you know if your car overheats, which obviously could happen, like it's going to
flag somebody down.
Yeah, it's going to be hours until anybody like helps you at all. Like there is nothing. Like there will be times you go through 5 hours and you won't see another car in the same direction as you. You know, you'll pass all the trucks in the other direction, but nobody will either pass you or you won't ever pass anybody else, because just everybody, it's so desolate. I mean, from the border of Idaho down to like Ely, Nevada, I mean, that's like a solid 5 hours of driving. You might pass through three towns that have a population of like 100 in them. I mean, might not be able to tether until I actually get within the Clark County general vicinity.
So the very first year, mentioning driving through Nevada, the very first year I bought, I think it's like 06, 07, I bought a fancy car and I thought, oh, it'll be fun to drive down to Vegas for the World Series this year. I went with my brother and Bunner. And we went down, and like you say, the highway is like a giant ribbon that just goes to the horizon. There's no turns.
Yep.
It's just dead straight. and you're going through desert.
Mostly only one lane in each direction, too.
Yeah, one lane each direction. You don't see anybody for 10 minutes coming the other way, right? And I thought, well, I just got this fancy car. Let's see how fast it goes. Because I'm not going to run into
anything. Sound later, like you.
Right? So my brother is passed out. He's completely out. Bunner's kind of half awake. And I get it going. And the speedo goes to 260 kilometers. And I get it going. I think I got it going 255 kilometers.
Wow. And what kind of car were you driving at the time?
What's that?
What kind of car were you driving at the time?
It was a BMW 545. And so I got it going. And it's automatic, obviously. But I think it was at like 250. You know how when you're an automatic and you hit a speed and all of a sudden it kicks into another gear, you can feel it go, it kicks another gear.
But
it
had one. High speed.
It had a gear at 250.
Wow.
How does it have a gear there?
I'm not shocked you don't spin the tires at that point.
And then I freaked out because there was a truck coming the other way, and I went, like a big 18-wheeler, and I'm like, oh, I got to slow down. So I did.
Yeah, before you catch air.
Yeah. Actually, that may or may not have happened if there's any law enforcement people listening.
No, of course not. That never happened. We wonder how we – any traffic court update this week?
I mean,
no traffic court update, but I do have a gas tank update. I finally ran my new pickup truck out of gas.
Oh, you hit the clean zero. Because I tried about, like, how many liters was your truck?
It's
100
liter tank.
And you were getting like 101 in there somehow.
No, it was 100.4, 100.5. Like I wanted to get as close, find out where the line was, right? And I kept getting more than 100. So I knew I was close. And I ran out of gas. And again, if you remember the last time, I wasn't far from the gas station last time. I think I had to cross the street or something. I coasted to, you know, across the street when we talked about it last time. This time I actually coasted into the gas station. I put it in neutral.
Wow.
Coasted into the gas station, but there was people like my gas tank's on the left hand side, and there's two islands, and people were on the right on both of them. So I had to kind of go in the wrong way, and I couldn't reach the hose, so I had to get like a water bottle and fill up and not
squirt a half a shot.
And you're not allowed to do it, right? Like when you put gas, it has to be in a, you know, in Canada they make it so it's got to be in this jerry can that's passed by safety stand, whatever. I just grabbed a empty water bottle and I kind of hid the hose with my body. Filled it up, but what happens when you run out of gas is the whole engine it pulls like air through the gas lines, right? So you can't just put gas in, start the car. Like the gas has got to go all the way through the system again, right? So here I am. It took like I want to say 12 or 13 fill-ups of a water bottle before. So I'm like covered in gas. I'm hiding. I'm thinking like the attendant's gonna see me. He's gonna call the cops or. There's going to be like a Zoolander moment where everything starts on fire.
Why didn't you just ask if they have a jerry can inside? Because they probably do.
I did. They wanted to sell me one.
Oh, okay. Well, that's a jerk. Just a
tactic. But anyway, so I filled it up and it was 100.6 liters. So I'd come within like 2 liters of running out of gas other times. Yeah, I was kind of proud of myself.
That is kind of proud of yourself. Might have also did damage to your car, but that's all right.
You probably tilted so many people with the irresponsibility in that story.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's just, yeah. I tilted my wife to all the hell, that's for sure. At least I know where Emily is now.
She was in the car?
No, but just telling her, because I drive my kids all over the place, like it could have, you know, it just tilts her to no end. She's the kind of person where it gets below half a tank and she's filling it up in case there's like an earthquake, right? That's kind of the it doesn't go on. Anyway, let's move on. Getting back to the World Series, the first non-Colossus event is Saturday. It's the 10K 7 Stud Championship. It starts at 3. Hopefully, our buddy Grapes jumps in that and Binks.
Sure, he'll be there. Yeah,
that'd be nice. The cash games are going. The single table satellites are going. I'd like to be there right now. This is the exciting time to be in Vegas. The daily deep stacks are running. So for those going, they're going to play those daily deep stacks. 2 p.m. daily is the 235, 30-minute levels, 15K starting stack. 5 o'clock, 5 p.m. daily, $185, 30-minute levels, 10K starting stack, excuse me. And then the super crapshoot, 7 p.m., $135 buy-in with $5,000 starting stacks. Re-entry tournament, so you can go crazy with those. The juice is a tad high in those. If I remember correctly, it's like 20% or something, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it might even be higher, but I'm not sure exactly what it is. I think, you know, you mentioned the crapshoot nature of it. I think there's actually a turbo that starts at nine at night. So for the 135 buy-in, it says $22.50 from each entry will be withheld for entry fees, and $12.50 will be withheld for tournament staff. So we're talking about 35. Yeah, so it's a 100 plus 35. So 35%, pretty. I mean, in fairness, you know, you're not playing against Doug Polk in that one. So no. you'll have some equity if you're good at poker.
This kid probably won't last another hour.
The ones that's the 9 p.m. turbo and the. I think the morning mega satellites have like 10 minute levels or something like that. Like, I mean, 10 minutes isn't even an orbit when you're talking about live poker.
Yeah.
So, 20 minute levels for the 300 buy-in. I think that's a 300 plus 65. So actually like the relative juice is not a lot better in that one, even though it's a turbo. So, you know, yeah, you know, you're paying for the experience to some extent of being at the Rio during the World Series of Poker, being in the same room as all the big guys and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, there's maybe better value tournaments all across town, but you know, if you don't have the bankroll for a World Series event, then a daily deep stack is your shot. That's what it is.
Way to go! In case you missed it, the province of Quebec in Canada passed a bill called Bill C-74 this week that is going to IP block blacklisted online gaming sites from the citizens of Quebec to be able to play online from their own homes and their computers. It's a pretty big deal. This is it's controversial. There's a lot of people saying the federal law, it violates federal law, and it's quite obviously protectionist for the Play Now website, the government-run Play Now website that's in Quebec. And they did mention, I think there's going to be a couple of licenses granted. Amaya is publicly traded in Quebec. So there's a lot of speculation that Amaya is going to get one of the licenses to be able to offer PokerStars and the Amaya platform to the citizens of Quebec. But it's a pretty big deal. And hopefully first of all, it's going to take it could be caught up in the courts for years with challenges, you know, different injunctions brought by sites that feel like this violates the federal law, et cetera. So, there's a lot still to be done. It's sort of early days as far as the news coming out of this, but it's fairly important if you want to read up on it. You live in Canada or Quebec and it interests you, to have a look. Google Bill C-74 Quebec online gaming and you'll get some articles.
Just C-74. I think the C usually stands for things that are national and then go through the House of Commons. So I think it's just Bill 74 in the Quebec legislature. But yeah, it's obviously like a scary precedent. Like you said, telecom in Canada is supposed to be managed on the national level, not the provincial level. Yeah. And so, you know, even aside from that, a lot of people are calling it super invasive. You know, we've seen this before with Russia doing very, very much, or attempting to do very much the same thing by going after ISPs and trying to blacklist the IPs of these sites. My gut feeling, for what that's worth, which is not much, is that it won't fly sort of because the privacy watchdogs aren't going to allow this to happen. I mean, I don't think that anybody is really in the corner of online gaming at this point. I mean, obviously, I would think that Amaya would throw some money, you know, attempting to block this thing and throw roadblocks in the way. But more from like a political and a privacy perspective, you know, it's sort of one of these things like, well, first they went for the online poker players and I did not speak up because I did not play online poker, right? Like, yeah. You know, gets to what happens next. You know, is pornography going to be banned? You know, based on that, is what other things can be banned? Eventually you get down the road to, well, websites that are too critical of the government should be banned. And, you know, it's a long road to that. But obviously once the precedent gets set, you know, there's a reason why we call these things slippery slopes.
Isn't Quebec like historically the province that doesn't want government overwatch and government at all? Don't they want to separate?
They definitely don't like federal government overwatch. I mean, Quebec historically has leaned somewhat more left of center, you know, politically. But I think they have a little bit of an authoritarianism in them. But what Quebec really doesn't like is the federal government telling them what to do. And this might be yet another manifestation of that. You know, if it turns out like Adam said off the top, this is something that, you know, is arguably unconstitutional. Like I said, telecom is generally considered the area of unlike in the United States, where most things are done on the state level. In Canada, most things are done on the federal level. The federal government has a lot more power in Canada than it does in the United States. So, yeah, I mean, Quebec definitely doesn't like the federal government telling them what to do. And so they like to kind of go their own way sometimes. And this is just another example.
Yeah, we'll see what becomes of it in the next weeks and months. I'm sure there'll be some more stuff to talk about as there are more developments. So let's move on. In case you missed it, the super fantastic High Roller Bowl is just about winding down. The final table is starting in about 45 minutes, I believe. They're down to 7 of the 49 starters. And Rainer Kempe leads with 5.5 million in chips. Others at the final table, Fetterholtz. He is second at 2.1. Brinkenny also has 2.1. Dan Shack has 1.7. Matt Berkey, who started day three. This is day four coming. Matt Berkey started day three with a big chip lead, made the final table. He's there with 1.2 million. Cyborg, Eric Seidel, 1.1 million. And one Philip Helmuth Jr., who made it to the final table as the short stack with 900,000 in chips. The blinds starting up today are going to be 25,000, 50,000. So the leader has about 100 big blinds. Short stack, Helmuth has 14. So it seemed like a pretty good structure. It looks like the final table made it with lots of play. Some great players, obviously, there are big names. Helmuth just continues to min cash these things or get to the final table. I mean, it's, you know, you think back to the one drops. He did quite well in those. There was some controversy. He and Dan Smith got into it pretty hard. Phil was apparently his old whining self. There was a lot of stuff. Hopefully, I haven't seen the coverage, but I believe they're going to rerun it. So I do want to see that.
Well, I mean, we've seen the way that Phil Helmuth plays short stacks, right? Like he's not reshoving light very often, or if he does, it's because of some like sort of weird read that he has on people. And then he'll do things like raise fold with like ace 10 or something like that, you know, something just completely insane. And with 14 big blinds, like you mentioned, he's the shortest stack. He's got 14 big blinds. Like he still thinks that he can outplay the field or, you know, nonsense like that. But, you know, we've seen him do stuff like that. Like just take really bizarre lines with like 6 big blinds and 5 big blinds. So with 14, he probably feels he has lots of time to navigate. But like you said, min cashing is significant to him. I think at this point, even though he would never admit that there's, you know, some money pressure, I'm sure he would not be, you know, he's not against laddering up at this stage.
I don't think he would also admit that he doesn't have 100% of himself, but
that's probably true.
King Dan Smith, actually, I guess you guys hadn't seen the coverage last night, but he was the bubble boy in the grossest fashion ever, really. He got into a pretty standard hand. He had sixes. The other guy had eights, and the flop came 6-8-10. That was Kempe, and they were both pretty even stacked. And the $600,000 set over set situation, and the coverage has been pretty awesome. I've really enjoyed it. Nick Shulman has been one of the commentators with Ali Najad, and it's been really awesome. Like, I think they're doing an amazing job. It's definitely some of the best poker TV I've seen since the high stakes poker era.
I was multi-channeling, trying to watch it, not yesterday, but the night before. I am, of course, in America, so I could just watch it on the old regular TV. So I'm multi-channeling between game 7 of the Warriors or the Thunder, game 1 of the Stanley Cup Finals, as well as the Super High Roller Bowl. Probably the only human being in America, actually caring equally about those. I mean, I don't know about equally, but cycling through those particular three sporting events in my time. And I agree. Nick Shulman, I mean, he's not a guy that I would have would have said, like, oh, yeah, that guy will make a great commentator on poker, but he's certainly done a really good job explaining things in a technical way. And I do like very much that he's not dumbing it down. You know, he is very much talking about people's ranges. He's not using a lot of lingo. So I think he's doing a great job approaching the gap where you talk about, you know, you talk about strategy in a way where the audience will be interested and engaged, but you also don't alienate you also don't alienate people by using a lot of verbiage that people don't understand.
He's also not awkward. He's very good at yes-ending and keeping the broadcast going smoothly. So that's really nice. With I'm assuming a guy who has basically no previous experience other than I know he's done quite a few final tables with Tuckman at the World Series, so he's had some practice there.
Yeah, I watched the first, I believe it was the first day, or I watched some of the first day, because up here in Canada, we couldn't watch it on any of the CBS networks, so we had to find it on Twitch or Periscope or wherever, where you could find it. But it was, first of all, it was great to have Ali back. I'm a huge Ali Najad fan. I think he's great with poker. And you guys mentioned it. And I think it goes to both of them, like, being together. Like, it's a really good combo. It both are really good at what they do. I think they're fantastic. And I hope to hear more from them for sure. So that's that was good to see. Sorry?
It's kind of funny because do you guys know the name Matt Berkey?
I do, yeah. He's like a – plays nosebleed in JRB's game.
Yeah.
In Aria. Yeah, he's a fixture there. He's a fantastic no limit cash game player.
Yeah, he before I met you guys, when I was at BCIT, a guy that I'd met at the casino who I tried to interview for one of my projects because I was trying to get poker interviews, and he's like, oh, well, I don't really want to interview you or do an interview with you, but I know a guy who would be great. And it turned out to be Matt Berkey, like 2 years ago. So my first ever poker interview, it's somewhere on SoundCloud, was with Matt Berkey.
Oh, wow. That's cool. I'd like to get that.
Yeah.
It'd be fun to hear what he has to say.
Yeah, we can make fun of that interview the way that Ross makes fun of 2008 Adam.
Exactly. All right. So let's move on. One more thing I wanted to get to before we ended the segment. T, I listened to you guys talk about the situation on Poker Night in America last week with Jacqueline Moscow, Nolan Dalla, Chris Hansen, and I can't remember the fellow's name. The guy who runs the Poker Night in America. But there's a couple of things. First, look, and you prefaced it too. You said you've been friends with Nolan for a while. So it's a difficult subject to talk about when your friend's involved. I've been sort of I wouldn't say I have a friendship with Nolan. I have an acquaintanceship with him. I don't think he would recognize me if I walked up to him. Like a lot of people don't. We're on radio. I'm rarely at places. So when I go up to somebody generally, I always introduce myself because, you know, how would they know what I look like? I think Nolan's probably in that thing. So I wouldn't say I'm close. I've never had dinner with him, anything like that. So I just wanted to get that out of the way before I talked about it. Some things in the in just to quickly give you the Cole's notes again. Jacqueline Moscow made some accusations about Nolan and some people at Poker Night in America that were pretty offensive. I think everybody would agree if they're true that they're quite offensive. And Nolan came on to 2+2 and he typed out a big statement about what his side of the story and some things sort of bothered me in there. And well, one of them mainly bothered me about what Nolan said. And, you know, when you look at this kind of situation, you want to try and figure out, you know, what makes sense. Like two people are saying two different things about an incident, right? So you want to figure out, you know, you'd like to figure out who's telling the truth. And when I look at what Nolan said, and one of the things he said in his thing is, I don't find her the least bit attractive. And that's a direct quote from his thing. And that just rubbed me really the wrong way for saying something like that, because it's not something that should be said in an apology or a statement about, not apology, but a statement about what happened that, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know if I didn't hear you guys talk about it. Maybe you mentioned it and I missed it, T, but, did you have a problem with that statement?
I mean, I have a problem with it in that it's like irrelevant.
Right.
It certainly doesn't advance his case. I mean, you know, what he says is, yeah, I've pulled it up there. With all due respect to Ms. Moscow, there's nothing I find the least bit attractive about her. And to allege I made a physical advance at her in a very public place is something that I completely deny. So that's the full context of the statement. It's basically an irrelevant piece of information, whether he finds her attractive, or not. I mean, in fairness, I guess there's a little bit, because part of the accusation is that, you know, I believe it was, just which part? I'm getting all my parties confused, but somebody, it might have been Todd Anderson, said that Nolan, you know, why are you here? Is it because Nolan has a thing for you? And then, you know, later on, Nolan allegedly says, you know, Jacqueline says this to Nolan, and Jacqueline says, you know, I was told that I'm only here because you have a thing for me. And then Nolan allegedly says, well, I do have a thing for you, or something like that. And I guess that's sort of the attempt at counter arguing. But okay, so there's a bunch of things that are going on here, and I guess one of the things to me is that even if the statement from Nolan isn't well written, it doesn't, of course, necessarily imply guilt, right?
No, that's not my point. My point is that it's not only is it irrelevant, it's kind of offensive to say that, right? So it doesn't strike me as something that should have been said.
I guess. I mean, clearly at this point, you know, they're not the best of friends, so he's not tremendously worried about offending her. Like you said, it's not an apology.
No, but you don't call somebody ugly, which is essentially what he's doing. Like, it's offside for me. So, and then I don't know if you guys watched Joey's podcast with the Jacqueline went on.
Yeah, I did.
I spent a bunch of time watching it.
There's a lot of things that didn't match up.
There's a lot of things in Nolan's statement that didn't match up to proof that she had. She had texts from Nolan saying, and there was a long discussion text about her coming on the set and coming and getting a spot in this specific game, and she was in town, come down, we'll try and find a spot for you. And then Nolan in his statement says she just showed up out of the blue, had no idea, basically, kind of thing. And so, you know, there's a few things that just sort of bothered me about the statement. I found her totally credible when I watched the podcast. Obviously we don't know what happened, but going on what we've had presented to us, it just looks to me like she was credible in what she said. T, did you watch the podcast?
I didn't. I have it sort of queued up to – I have, you know, on my phone so that I can listen to it on my drive down. Like I said, I've got 20 hours of driving ahead of me, sure. So I figured I'm gonna catch up on stuff like that. I have no reason to disbelieve the things that she said. I have no reason to disbelieve the things that Nolan has said. I feel we have no information at this point, or not enough information anyway. Like, this is sort of what I wrote on 2+2. I made a rare appearance at NBG to make a fairly lengthy post on this topic. And my general thought on this is that we don't know, and no good can sort of come out of speculating, in the sense that, okay, if you speculate, regardless of what side is another, if whether you believe that Jacqueline Moscow is telling the truth, you know, and that Nolan is this, you know, this deviant who has done these really awful things, or you believe Nolan's side that Jacqueline Moscow is making these things up, and things are not nearly as they happened, there's basically no reward for being right. And there is a downside to being wrong, not for yourself, but basically for these people, right? So if Jacqueline is telling the truth, and you say that, oh, I don't believe her, I think she's a liar, then you're basically throwing insult to injury. This is a woman who has been, you know, has been wronged, has been assaulted physically, has been made to feel very uncomfortable. And now what you're doing is making things from bad to worse by saying, oh, I think she's a liar. Similarly, if Nolan is innocent of these things and he didn't do these things, and this is a fabricated story or an exaggerated story, and you take the other point of view as saying, oh, well, okay, you know, women almost never make up stories like this. Like, she's clearly a victim here and he's clearly like a dirty old pervert. You know, then you've ruined a person's reputation without basis. And, you know, even if it comes to light later on that.
Okay. So what point do you have at what point do you have enough evidence to to make that decision? Like,
I'm not sure that we will. I mean, I think witness, like any sort of eyewitness thing is significant at this point. There were, you know, there were alleged witnesses to this, you know, this motorboating thing. Obviously, like, you know, you mentioned text messages. That's going to go a long way. We've got emails.
One of them was, one of the witnesses was, Chris Capra, who I believe is works with 888. He was there. She showed text messages from him saying, "I'm sorry about the behavior. I'm sorry I egged it on."
Right. Yeah, I did see that.
So, I mean, for her to make up this whole story to include these witnesses and text seems pretty hard.
I mean, but let me ask you something. How confident are you that the story is as she's presented?
Say that again, sorry.
Let me ask you just a question. Like, what percentage are you confident that the story happened as she said it, or more or less as she said it? Like, what is the level of confidence here?
I mean, I don't know that I have enough to make that, but that was my question.
Okay, so there we go, right? Like, so that's the thing, right? Like, so, you know, I don't think most people at this point, most reasonable people would say, like, I'd be willing to lay, like, 9-1 that one side is telling the truth or the other, regardless of what you're currently situation. Right. Like, if you would be willing to lay big odds, like, you're probably making a really big mistake. So I don't know that we will ever have all of this information. I mean, you know, I don't know how much more there is, right? So Jacqueline Moscow has shown some text messages. Nolan has presented some emails. We don't have any sort of, like, witnesses that have come forward and said this happened or this definitely didn't happen. That is the thing. And I don't know what's going to change in the next little while that's going to happen.
Other than somebody coming forward and saying, I saw this happen. I saw Nolan do it.
Right. I was there the whole night and I didn't see this happen.
Neither's happened, which is important, right? Neither of those things have happened.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I just don't know. That's why I don't like speculating on this. I don't like speculating with respect to the did he or didn't he, because there's just so little upside, right? I think everybody agrees. Excuse me. Still suffering from the bug in the throat, but I think everybody believes and everybody agrees that if a person does what Nolan was alleged to have done, like, that person deserves to be punished. That person deserves to be castigated, to have a poor reputation within the community, you know, and amongst his
peers. I mean, that's a physical assault.
Arguably that, although it seems unlikely that that would happen at that point. I mean, it's very clear that everybody agrees on that. All we can't agree on is what likelihood that the events were what, the way that Jacqueline described it or that Nolan described it. And we're really not, like, I think it's unlikely that we're going to know at this point. And it's not a very fun position to take, like, the sober approach and say, oh, well, let's see what comes out in the wash, or I don't have enough information to make a decision right now, because that's not exciting, right? Like, that's not what draws page views. What draws page views is, this is an outrage. This is another example of, you know, misogyny in poker, or this is another example of a woman trying to use a situation to blackmail a man, you know, or blackmail a company, or to make a name for herself. Like, both of those point of views are ridiculous, and they're extremist, and they're pointless. And if you're espousing one of these, you know, I think you should be ashamed of yourself, because the fact is, like, if you think it's like a 30-70, that's fine. If you think it's a 40-60, I think that's fine. Like, but I don't think you can have any more certainty than that.
All right, let's move on. Hopefully we can get to happier stuff in the next segment, where we're going to talk to Mr. Doug Polk. He's going to join us from Las Vegas. He's just finished up playing in the super fantastic, awesome High Roller Bowl. Busted out early before the money. We're going to talk to him about the World Series of Poker. He's got a Twitter feud going with one Jason Mercier.
Shots fired!
And we're going to also be joined by Matthew Hilger from the Isle of Man. He's going to come on and talk to us about what's going on over at PokerStars. Roscoe, what do you got PLOQuickpro-wise?
All right, guys. PLOQuickpro is the only site that has an entire suite of PLO courses designed by World Series of Poker bracelet winner John Beaupres, who is going to join us in the third segment, and 5K PLO scoop winner Alien Slayer, over the past few years, they've successfully taught more than 1,000 players how to master the fundamentals, increase their win rate, and move up in stakes for good. So whether you're a small or micro stakes grinder trying to become a winner for the first time, or you're already a winner and you're trying to make more money and move up to the mid stakes, especially if you're just a no limit player and you're looking to transition to this great four card game, they've got videos, PDFs, tutorials, and all sorts of content that will help you plug your leaks and look at the game in a new way. So if you'd like to learn the guaranteed fastest way to master the fundamentals, increase your win rate, and move up in stakes for good, visit PLOQuickpro.com/pokercast or reach John personally at john@PLOQuickpro.com. And stay tuned in the third segment when we'll have him on for some free pointers.
Yeah, we're going to talk to him and get some PLO stuff in there. You're listening to the 2 Plus 2 PokerCast presented by the PokerStars VIP Club. More right after this.
Hey, poker fans. Don't forget about the 2plus2.com digital magazine. Each month, a wide array of poker professionals and media write fascinating articles about the game you love. Want to learn about big blind versus small blind hand ranges? How about optimal Jeopardy daily double strategy? Topics like those and many others are covered every month. Head on over to 2plus2.com to see what the magazine has to offer this month.
At blinds 120K, 240K, it's folded to me in the cutoff, and I raise ace-king off to 480,000 with a stack of 14.6 million. Button folds, and the small blind 3-bets to 1.25 million with an effective stack of 8.9 million. I've played with the guy some in previous days. I felt he wouldn't flat call many hands from the small blind and was capable of getting out of line pre-flop. I 4-bet to 2.15 million with the intention to call his shove. He went all in, I quickly called, and he also had ace-king off. The flop came down with three clubs. I had the king club, but he had the ace of club. The turn was another club, and I doubled him up.
Team Pro Online's Marc-Andre French Dog Ladouceur is a Supernova VIP. This is the 2 Plus 2 PokerCast, presented by the PokerStars VIP Club.
Okay, people, most of the kittens have perished. There are a few left you can save, though, and here's how to do it. Get involved with the PokerCast by emailing your questions, suggestions for the show, or even record a sound clip. Adam will be using the best ones on the air. Well, let's face it, probably the worst ones as well. I can see you there at your computer. Send an email right now. Totally disagree with one of Adam's takes last week? Send an email. Love last week's interview? Email. Want to know how much cash Adam has on him right now? Email. Pokercast@2plus2.com is the address. Ship the funny to Adam today.
And you don't explain.
Welcome back to the 2 Plus 2 PokerCast, presented by the PokerStars VIP Club. Terrence is having some internet issues in Seattle, of all places, but so we're going to fire ahead here quickly and get this Doug Polk interview in. Doug, welcome back to the PokerCast, sir.
Awesome. Thanks for having me back. I think the last time I was on the cast, wasn't I in Pittsburgh doing the bot challenge? I can't
remember. You were.
That's
right. That's right.
I think that was it. Which, by the way, it's been almost exactly 1 year. So in some ways, you know, it's our anniversary.
Happy anniversary, Doug. I didn't get you anything.
Oh, typical.
Well, I'll tell you what. How about for an anniversary present, we get into this little bit of a Twitter feud you had with Jason Mercier. I got a kick out of it. I know a lot of people did. It was strange because, and I'll let you, you know, explain it to us, but it all seemed to stem from the fact that Jason didn't watch your Twitch stream that you've been doing now for quite some time. I've been watching it. It's awesome. I'm a subscriber. And but it seemed like some of Jason's friends had been watching the stream and run to Jason and said, "Hey, Doug has you labeled as a bad reg." And then the tweet started. Is that fair? Is that what happened?
That's like a fairly accurate Well, I guess I'll just take it from the top. And, you know, I've known Jason for many years. And back in the day, like 6, 7, 8 years ago, I can't even remember how long ago anymore, we both played like small stakes full ring on Pokerstars. Okay. So, you know, we'd play 1-2 full ring every day and chat on AIM or whatever, right? It was good times. And so I've known Jason for a long time, and I don't in any way think that he's a bad guy or like hate him or like I feel like some people are like, oh yeah, Tug and Jason, they're sitting next to each other in a 300K, like, you know, shit's gonna hit the fan, like, yeah, Tug is gonna put him in his place, and like Jason's gonna like throw some punches, and like it's really nothing like that. I think he's a very nice person, and I've had no bad interactions with him. I just don't think his poker game is very strong. And really what happened was, you know, on my stream, when I play poker in general, I have, you know, labels because you can color code sure. people different codes. And, you know, every serious online poker player codes people because it's a good way to kind of, like, see how good a table is or bad is or whatever. And as I started streaming, I kind of realized this, you know, out of the gate. I've been streaming for about 2.5 months now, actually. But I realized kind of out of the gate that I'm going to have a problem here because people can now see who I think is a good or a bad reg, you know? Right. Yeah. And so I was like, well, do I take this down? Like, do I like just have no color codes? And, you know, I was kind of like, you know what? I'm just going to do my thing. And then, like, I'm not going to just change this because, you know, it might upset people. It's the way I think. It's like, you know, I'm not like attacking people for no reason. I'm just going to keep my exact color codes as they are. And that means that some people are going to get labeled bad regs, people that, you know, may or may not be good people. They're just going to be, you know, labeled as they are. So I think what happened was, you know, I think people were constantly messaging Jason and they were saying, hey, you know, the dog has you labeled as a bad reg. And you know, at some point my stream had like 6, 7, 8,000 people watching. I'm sure anyone that knows Jason when they saw that, like was letting him know. So I think in some ways, he felt like he kind of has to stick up for himself, you know? Even though, like, I'm not, like, directly saying, like, you know, and this isn't, like, an attack on Jason. It's just kind of, you know, what happened. But I think he felt the need to stick up for himself. And then he took to Twitter, and then it just kind of, like, went down. Then it was just, like, you know, he was trash-talking me a little bit. I was, like, saying, like, okay, I'm willing to play you. And by the way, we actually have played in some mixed games. I know he was trying to make it sound like, you know, I just play no limit. And I wouldn't play him in mixed games, but I think I'm up like 100,000 on him in mixed games, and he quit me. So it was super ridiculous for him to be like, "Oh yeah, you're a heads up no limit pro. Like, let's play some mixed games." And I'm like, "Wait, what are you talking about? You know, like I don't understand what your point is." Anyway, and then Negreanu jumped in, and then Doyle jumped in, and Luke Schwartz jumped in, and like people were throwing punches, and really this culminated in during the 300K. It was a random seat draw, and we were, you know, drawing seats next to each other. And I remember on one of the breaks, I was going to the restroom, and it was being broadcasted by CBS Sports, right?
Sure.
So, you know, on the way to the restroom, I'm just like watching the TV, just to kind of see what people had, because we were both on the feature table. And I looked down, and it's showing our tweets on like national TV. Like, he says this, I say that. And I'm just like, wow, this is really, from like what it originally was, which was, you know, me having him color coded blue, which means bad reg, to like, dude,
television.
This is now it's now a national feud. It's just like so insane, crazy. You know?
Yeah.
So that's like really, I guess, like the cliffs on what happened there.
Fair enough. Terrence is back on the line. Terrence, you there?
Yeah, I am. And, you know, you've made it when, you know, your Twitter beef is now a national television item.
Right.
But of course, I wanted to ask you, Doug. So, you know, Jason's made this sort of allegation that, oh, you would never play me at mixed games, but you're saying it's completely untrue. You have, in fact, played him in mixed games. You know, would you expect, you know, a challenge to go down between the two of you? I mean, obviously you would obviously have, you know, you would feel a very big advantage in big bet games, but would you be willing to take him on in a mixed game challenge?
Sure. I mean, but here's the thing though. He's stone dead in that format. And he's actually quite bad heads up in all of the mixed games. You know, maybe he's beating me small in like the stud, And like the limit hold'em's kind of whatever. I'm probably like treading water, or maybe slightly losing in all of the mix in all of like the limit games, right? Maybe even winning. I don't know. It's close. But in like the no limit in PLO, he's just getting absolutely massacred, and those games have the biggest win rate. So the problem is, you know, for him, he just has no way to win that format. And it just, you know, I responded to his tweet. I was like, hey man, like, let's do this. Like, heads up eight game. Like, I mean, you know, I'll play. Let's go. I actually think I might even worry a little bit different. I was like, all right, I guess I'll play some eight game. Probably losing here, but I'll give it a shot. And just cause like people are reading that are like, you know, they might interpret it differently. But anyway, he's not going to play that. Like it's just a charade. It's just like a way of being like, oh yeah, you're a one trick pony. That might even have been in his tweet, and then be like, yeah, let's do anything else. And I'm like, okay, well, how about like all of the things you do, you know? And then like, for some reason, he doesn't have to back that up. And there was a tweet that he responded with that I thought was like notable because it kind of gave me a glimpse into the way that he sees the situation. When I said like, okay, let's play heads up eight game, he's like, you know, come play with us. We are waiting for you. And I was like, I read that and I was like, so you're challenging me to like multi-handed eight game? Like, right. I think about like in the terms of insults, like, yeah, man, you suck. How about we play a little six max eight game with a bunch of other people? Like, I just don't really understand.
Right. They're different, you know, skill sets. Like, certainly. I mean, everybody understands that heads up and six max are different skill sets, but it's not usually the way that the gauntlet gets thrown in these circumstances.
Yeah, I mean, like, what are you trying to say? Like, yeah, I don't play multi-handed mixed games. I play tournaments. I'm willing to crossfit there. I play heads up no limit. I'm obviously willing to play you there. I play heads up PLO. I'm willing to play you there. I play heads up eight game. I'm willing to play you. Like it's just so unreasonable to come out with that attack on me when like it's just not even true. And like the people that are just like glancing by, like, oh yeah, Doug will only play heads up no limit. He's not willing to do all the other things. When like that's just a lie. So I felt like, you know, I definitely needed to kind of get in there and like throw a couple punches back, you know?
Yeah. I find it strange that just, I mean, I don't, you say he felt the need to, you know, defend himself, but just because one of his opponents has him labeled as a bad reg, like, I don't get why that matters at all. Like,
well, isn't, you know, that sort of the thing that you want in poker for people to think,
right,
that you're bad
in general?
Yeah.
That's a good thing if you use it properly, kind of, you know, or whatever. I don't know. I mean, it just seems. Just seems to be strange, but we have a limited amount of time with Doug. He's starting a stream shortly, so let's get right to some of the topics we want to talk about. And one of the topics is that stream. You mentioned it, Doug, 2.5 months. It's been a lot of fun watching somebody like yourself play in the highest games online, the biggest tournaments, the biggest cash games. It's really neat. I know I've probably watched more of your Twitch channel than I've watched of anybody's. It's fun. Like, you know, are you enjoying doing it?
I actually, so when I first found Twitch, I was like, you know what, like, I'll like throw my hat in the ring, see if like it sticks, see if anyone wants to watch me, see if I enjoy it. And frankly, it's like exceeded my expectations in every way. I've loved doing it. I've managed to get like a pretty good growth. You know, I'm like one of the biggest streams now in terms of poker. Obviously nowhere near the top because Jason Sommerville just has done such a great job with his stream that, you know, there's quite the gap there, right? But, you know, other than him, I would say I'm in the running with, like, the other couple big guys. And, yeah, we've only been streaming for, like, I've only been streaming for a couple months. So to see that kind of growth, and then just to, like, see, like, how pumped people are. Like, so many people watch my stream, and they're like, this is just the best thing ever. Like, please stream all day, every day, you know? And, like, just to see that feedback and, like, interact with people, and then watch the numbers grow, and watch the viewers grow, and really just, like, have a good time with it. It's just been great. And that's really, I guess, what the focus is a bit more on. You know, obviously, I've started a coaching website called Upswing Poker. And because I have the coaching side of things, I tend to be a little less strategy-based on my stream than the other guys are. Because I feel that, like, you know, having made it to kind of the top of poker, I feel like that strategy insight is extremely valuable. I can't just be like, hey, guys, I'm selling products on my site, you know, my coaching site, but
here, I'll show you here.
Watch me on stream and get the value, right? So it's a bit more like, it's a bit more based on like, what's the action, what's going on, having a good time, maybe occasionally answering some like strategy questions, but keeping it really limited. answering people's questions about poker or other regs or what games, you know, do you like or what games do you play or like what my thoughts on things are. I just try and keep it like high energy, lots of jokes, troll some people, and just like basically just try and have a really good time, you know?
It's entertaining, right? That's the key, right? You know, there's streams out there that probably aren't as entertaining. Yours, for anybody who hasn't watched it, is a real fun watch, and the house goats, all the fun stuff is great. Somebody did tweet in, they asked, maybe I think they probably understand what you just said about strategy, but there was a question where the guy said maybe you could do some high level heads up but hide your hole cards. Is that something you could think about?
You know, that's also something that's kind of reasonable, but here's the problem, really. PokerStars recently just like, you know, dropped the hammer on the rake in those games to where it's extremely difficult to win against good people.
Gotcha.
So PokerStars is kind of off the table for high stakes battling. And then past that, and by the way, I actually have done that a little bit. Like, I played some 5100 against Jungle on stream and people were going nuts because obviously that was pretty ridiculous. Yes. Not too often you get to see like a 5100 reg battle going down live on Twitch. But, you know, it's not something I'm against necessarily. It's just a bit of a pain because first off, you have to block the hole cards. And I think it's debatable if people enjoy that or not. Like, would you rather watch small to mid stakes with hole cards or high stakes with no hole cards? I think you might get a mixed bag there. Like, the true poker fans, right? They're gonna love the 5100 because like only a few people are even doing that. So just getting a chance to like see that go down is cool. And you know, even when I'm hiding my hole cards, I do like, you know, if I get a big bluff through and I think it's like a hand that like I don't mind letting people see, I'll just be like, all right, got him guys, and like so pull it to the side and like, you know, you see my, like if you go to like Upswing Poker's YouTube page, I got like a huge bluff through on Jungle at 5100, and so like now that's on YouTube. And there's this one guy who always comes into my chat named Danmer. And Danmer's like this guy who plays high stakes heads up, but he's like real picky with when he plays. So he doesn't really play many people. But then he's always like, yeah, guys, I'm the best ever. No one's as good as me. Doug, I'm number one. Yeah, what's up? And then like everyone's like, okay, let's play heads up. And he's like, oh, well, my bankroll's small and like my backer won't let me. And like, it's just like so funny because he just like talks so much shit, right? Anyway, this one time we were playing 5100 on stream, and there was like a fish in the pool, so he jumped in. And we were in a 3-bet pot, and he bet jammed, and I had the nuts on the river. And I was like, oh my god, this is such a tough spot. And I just like, I turned off the hole card blockers so you could just see that I had the nuts. I'm like, that's it, guys, we're slow rolling him right now. And like, the chat's just going nuts. Yeah. And then like, he like shows up in the chat like afterwards because of 5-minute delay, right? And he's just like, oh man, I hate you. Like, just like so mad about everything because, I don't know, that's really what I'm trying to do. You know, I'm really trying to like embrace the fun side of poker.
Yeah.
Because the thing is, Twitch is mainly people that watch video games and then they're like, oh wow, poker. You know, that I've heard about poker. And like, I don't want them to like pull up my stream and I'm like, okay, so I threw that check raise and I figure here his range is like this and like, you know, when I check raise, it's like these hands, like, I just want to be like, oh, what's up? I got top pair. You know, I just want to keep it super high energy, have a good time with it, and appeal to more of that, you know, wide range of audience members.
Well, if you look back at the origins of poker on Twitch, you look at guys like Sticky Rice, that's what it was. He got a huge following because he was super entertaining, right?
Yeah, definitely. Actually, I have a funny little fact here. I am actually, like, the true OG of Twitch streaming. Because in 2009, I did a prop bet. 2008, I did a prop bet where I had to win $10,000 a month at NL25.
Yeah.
Cliff notes, I failed. But I was like, I'm going to stream this because, you know, people will be interested and they'll come check it out. And I remember I used to have like, I got like 1,000 or 1,500 people watching in like 2008 on stream.
That's it.
And like it was a real shitty stream. Like you could see my chair, you could barely see the monitor or whatever. And that was on a site called Justin TV. Well, Twitch actually bought Justin TV, and that's what Twitch is now today. So,
cool.
I got some roots in it here, you know.
Before it was cool.
Yeah. One thing I got to ask you before we let you go is, you know, we've talked a lot. There's a lot been in this discussion about streaming and balance and hiding information and all this kind of stuff. you know, you're a guy who works very hard on your game, clearly. Do you ever, you know, not necessarily watch other people who might be streaming, but do things like look at like hole cards and hand histories from the scoop replays, things like that. You had a, you know, you made a bunch of deep runs in scoop, including shipping that watch, of course. Are you interested at all in how other people play, or is it mostly your own game? What are the kinds of things that Doug Polk studies to stay at the top of the heap?
Well, it's interesting because most of the other streamers, and I don't mean this in a negative way because I think for some reason it gets like a negative stigma attached to it, but they're more entertainers, you know, than they are. I don't want this to sound mean because I think it almost does sound mean, but they're more entertainers than poker players, right? I mean, they're varying skill levels. Some are pretty good. Some are okay. But their focus is to be entertaining. So with other people's streams, I don't end up finding a lot of value in watching them in a strategy standpoint. Like, I might watch them for entertainment, but because the reason is they're not playing the games that I'm in, and they don't really play high stakes overall in general. And there's a couple exceptions. I think Tonka is probably the most notable one, and Somerville gets in for some higher stakes stuff too every now and then. But as far as trying to stay ahead of the curve, I do a lot of work with the guys that, you know, I back I have like a crew of guys, you know, and we oftentimes study ranges and stats and samples to kind of see what's going well, what's not going well. But nowadays I'm a little less concerned overall with trying to stay at like that top spot. And I'm a little more concerned with trying to grow my business, trying to find a way to reach out to like coach people, you know, from recreational levels up, you know, with Upswing Poker. And I think that's really what Upswing has done differently than a lot of the other coaching sites. We are really dedicated to reaching out to those people that are starting poker, that are new to poker, that, you know, want to learn, like, they don't want to go to a site and just get, like, a ton of videos. They want to go to a site and, like, okay, so here's how to think. Here's the way you play pre-flop. Here's what you should do in the, you know, just really take that, like, step-by-step approach. And we're, like, pretty excited about, you know, where things are going with Upswing.
Nice. Upswing is yourself, Ryan Fee, and is there other coaches involved there?
So there's three owners of Upswing Poker. It's myself, Ryan Fee, and Matt Coletta. Ryan Fee, also a high stakes pro. He's done very well in many different formats, including, you know, Heads Up Cash being his main one. I think he's fairly well known. And sure. Then Matt Coletta is a little more off the grid, but he also made millions from poker. But then, you know, Black Friday hit. And he had a real tough decision. It was leave California or continue to have a career. And, I mean, who really wants to leave California?
Not a lot of people. you're in Vegas. World Series of Poker plans. I know a lot of people out there putting their fantasy teams together. What's Doug Polk doing for the World Series?
So I think I'm going to kind of do a little mix here. I'm going to primarily do some streaming on the American sites. Definitely want to keep trying to grow my stream and have a lot of fun with it. Frankly, I comparing playing to like streaming, I just love streaming so much more. That's probably where I'm going to spend my time. I'm going to be in the mix for the bigger events. Like, you know, there's a 10K heads up in a few days I'll play. There's, you know, the 10K six max I'll play. The 100K one drop I'll play. The 10K main I'll play. You know, all of like the bigger high value events, yeah. I'll still get in there for. But like, you know, a couple of years ago when I actually won a bracelet, I had a bunch of bracelet bets, and I was just grinding out every day. I'm not sure if you guys ever done that, but it gets pretty miserable.
Yeah. Busting out of events, walking down the hallway, you know, 10 events in a row, and you want to commit suicide.
You don't even get to walk down the hallway. Most of the time, you don't get to walk down the hallway. You just walk from the cage right back to the registration
to the
table
next event.
To the next event, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, so I don't really want to put that burden on myself where I feel like, you know, I have to wake up and just grind every day. If I decide I just really want to go play a tournament, I want to be able to do that and not feel burnt out because, you know, I'm still going to be playing some occasional high stakes cash games. I'm still going to be playing some occasional high stakes tournaments. I'm still going to be streaming. I have a lot going on, and I don't want to feel like I'm exhausted because I was playing like a millionaire maker, you know?
Yeah, no question. Okay. Well, thanks, Doug, so much. Appreciate your time. I know you got to run. Have a good World Series, sir. Have some fun. Play some online and get in those big ones and bank one of them.
Thanks, guys.
That was Doug Polk. Thanks, Doug. Hope he takes something down there. And from Las Vegas, Nevada. What?
Maybe on the you know, he'll pick up a big score on the stream. You know, that Pokercast karma is real.
So it'll be WSOP.com, I guess, that he's playing in Nevada.
Yeah, surely.
Maybe when they're going to love satellite.
Want to get in trouble playing any sort of, you know, secondary questionable site that may be based offshore, but yet still allow Americans to play. I don't think he would do such a thing.
Not sure. From Las Vegas, we're going to head over to the Isle of Man and talk to our old friend, Mr. Matthew Hilger from PokerStars headquarters. Matthew, welcome back to the show.
Thank you very much. How are you guys?
All good. Haven't talked to you in a little while. We got a couple of things to talk about going on over at PokerStars. One of them I noticed was the return of the $1 million spin and goes.
Yes, I believe this is our fourth edition of this, $5 spin and go, and you can win $1 million. We've given away 9 $1 million prizes so far in the history of this this little $5 special buy-in. Mm-hmm. And so we'll see if we add to that list this summer.
You've given away 9, Matthew, or people have won 9, but really there's just one in our hearts, and that was the fantastic – I can't remember.
Alexander. Oh, how dare you, Adam.
I blanked.
Best guest in history in the 11-year history of this show, possibly.
No question. He was great.
We're still not sure that you didn't actually just plant him on our show to do spin and go promotion, excuse me.
I mean, they're a lot of fun, and you know, if anybody has a chance and check YouTube, you know, there's a couple of YouTube videos out there that you know, watch these things in the entirety, and you know, if you're a player and you hit this thing, and then 60 seconds later, you're playing for $1 million. I mean, there's no buildup; it's just instantaneous, and then you're at it. So it's just a very unique product. I mean, in a regular tournament, you at least, you know, you're building up and you realize you're going to be winning some big money. But in this case, you have no time to prepare for it mentally. And it's a lot of fun. And so we'll see how, if anybody hits it again.
There's a little another promotion going on at Stars that's slightly more attainable, I noticed. This is the a pyramid promotion. If you go to your account at PokerStars, check on your promotions folder, and you're going to run into the pyramid promotion where, Matthew, maybe you can explain it exactly, but I think you get points for getting different hands when you're playing Zoom or full stake. Is it full ring, no limit hold'em?
Yeah, cash games and Zoom. It's a puzzle. Has 23 pieces, and it's in the shape of a pyramid. And you collect puzzle pieces by winning with kings or better. So if you win with kings or better, you'll collect a piece at the bottom of the pyramid, and if you win with a flush, you collect the very the top piece. And if you win with a flush, you actually win multiple pieces. So because you'll win the two pair hand, the three of a kind puzzle, the straight puzzle, and the flush piece all at the same time. So it's a very kind of a unique promotion. It's in a way, it's you know, the card hunt that we ran not very long ago was quite successful. It was one of our most engaging promotions that we've had in a long, long time. And this is similar. It's for, you know, Zoom and cash game players. The prize is similar. You went up to $5,000. One of the complaints that we had in Card Hunt was that it was too difficult to win the top prize, and we've increased the odds of that by four times more winners this time than in the Card Hunt promotion. And I believe over 50% of the players will win $2 or more when they complete the puzzle. and the bottom prize is a dollar, what some like to call the rage dollar. But it's a fun, it's a daily puzzle, and so you can play it every single day, and I think it's going to be a lot of fun and something unique and different out there for cash game players.
So 2 weeks ago, I got – well, 1 second, Adam, because I haven't been able to brag about this on the show yet, even though it's been 2 weeks, and I have to with Matthew on the line because I have a clarification question. During the scoop, I believe it was the main event in the low of the main event, I was dealt 9-8. The flop came 9-9-8. The turn was a 9, and the river was an 8. And I'm pretty sure that's the first time in my life I'd ever made – quads full of trips. Which tier of card does that get? Do I just get all the cards if I were to hit that during the pyramid? Because I feel like I just
That would be a good way, but in technically you'll collect 5 different pieces. You won't collect the whole puzzle.
Okay. Well, that's disappointing.
Is that called something?
I still got my brag out there.
You know that I think actually it's a decent idea. Obviously not what you had, but maybe we should consider like. If you get a straight flush or something, you just you get the whole puzzle, you know, automatically. That could be something we could look into ration. But we're trying to do a lot of different things. You know, I've been with the company for 2 years now, a little over 2 years. And in the beginning, the first year and a half, we did a lot of promotions that were, you know, just basically a lot of reruns, golden sit and goes and milestone hands. And we started those daily challenges. If you remember daily challenges over a year ago, they were like, you know, play 10 real money hands or you know, things like that. And we've really been working on the technology, and it's a lot more flexible now, and we can do a lot more innovative things. So doing things like card hunt and pyramid, and we got some exciting new things planned for the fall as well. So we'll see how it goes. Hopefully players will like it.
Just quick point of clarification: when you said when you win a hand with kings are better, you don't mean pocket kings. You can have like ace king and be a king on the flop. That's kings are better, right?
Exactly.
And the last note, Matthew, is a bit of a sad note. We've here at the Pokercast, we've been a partner with PokerStars for I believe it's 8 years now. That's coming to an end at the end of June. We're parting ways. Sad to not be in business anymore, Matthew. But can't thank you guys enough over there in the Isle of Man for being alongside of us for so long.
Yeah, I mean, the same here. It's been a great partnership working with 2+2 PokerCast over the years. This wasn't in no way at all was this decision a reflection on 2+2 or the PokerCast or you guys. It's really just, a kind of a matter of, recent developments with, we have our own channels now with EPT and Twitch. And so we're really just moving in that direction for our, spoken communications. But I've had a great time working with you guys. I want to give a big thanks to the PokerCast. You guys have a great show, and it's a great platform to discuss important topics in the poker community. I think you guys know we've had a lot of light conversations about promotions. But we've also had a lot of controversial topics in the time that I've been here. And I mean, it's a great program. And, I knew it was a long time, but I didn't realize it was 8 years. It's the end of a long partnership, but at the same time, we will still be having a presence at 2+2. We'll still be in the forums. I want to thank you guys. You guys have been very nice to me as well and very helpful and through a lot of interesting and controversial topics. And I appreciate that.
Oh, no problem. Thank you too. So
I wanted to express my sort of personal gratitude that you never shied away from those topics. You never said we're not going to discuss all all these things that I'm sure at times made you uncomfortable. You know, you're a spokesperson, you're not, you know, an official spokesperson, but, you know, you do come on in that role and have to talk about, you know, things that are certainly going to be unpleasant. You know, so we appreciate that you came on and, you know, spoke about these things candidly. You never told us what we couldn't say. You never told us, you know, not to criticize where we felt that criticism was warranted. So, I mean, we very much appreciate, you know, our license to, you know, just to speak freely. And I think that's something that we've said on the show before, but even with the sponsorship relationship ending, I feel needs to be reiterated.
I think that's a really important point, Terrence. Not once in the 8 years that I've been with PokerStars did they ever say, we don't want you talking about this or anything like that, or we're unhappy with the fact that you said this. Not one time. And for a title sponsor to, you know, write a check for a show to make it possible to get out there every week, to leave the hosts to basically talk about, you know, let's face it, PokerStars is the biggest name in poker, and specifically online poker that we talk a lot about, and you know, some things good and both good and bad happen along the way. And Stars was, it's an excellent point, Terrence, that we were never directed in any form or any way to, with the narrative of the show. And I really, really appreciate that. And I don't know that we'll ever find that, or anybody will ever find that again.
Well, I thank you very much for those comments. I mean, the reason we sponsored the show all these years is because, it's such a influential and great platform for the poker community, and it was important to uphold that at all times. And I think I've told you, you know, ask the hard questions, and you know, I'll do my best to answer them. And I think it was a great partnership in that respect. And now we move on to the next chapter, and I'm sure there'll be more discussions along the way on what PokerStars is doing, you know, that's always going to be there, right?
Indeed. We've got a month left to go, so we'll be the end of June. We might see if we can sneak you on one more time or two before it's all over. But again, thanks so much, Matthew, and we will talk to you soon.
Okay. Thank you very much, guys. Appreciate it.
There it is, T, the end of an era, so to speak.
Yeah, you know, it's going to feel weird for sure. You know, we're, you know, like searching. Yeah, I know you've been on the sponsorship search hunt, but you know, it's like you said, you said, you know, we don't know if we'll ever be able to find a host that was so cool with us talking a wide variety of topics. I certainly hope that we will. A sponsor I certainly hope that our sponsor was as cool as these guys were in that. And we, you know, we really do mean it, that they never tried to censor us or anything like that. At best, they would always say, you know, whether it was Matthew, or maybe it was Brian Slick, or whether it was Steve Day, you know, so at worst they would say something like, oh boy, I really said that badly, I'd like to rephrase that, and then we would just hit the report button again. But you know, that's stuff that's coming out of their mouth. That's totally understandable. We're not here to gotcha anybody anyway.
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah, we're definitely open to talking to somebody. If there's somebody out there who listens to the show that offshore gambling sites and are interested in becoming a sponsor on the PokerCast, PokerCast at 2plus2.com, send in an email if that's something that might interest you. But yeah, it's going forward, you know, we're sort of at a crossroads here. We got to figure out what we're going to do, if we're going to keep on going, how we're going to keep on going. We'll see how it plays out here in the next little while.
Is there anybody that know out there that knows a bacon company?
Because I don't mind talking about bacon for an hour a week.
This is going to be the 2+2 bacon cast, like that. Yeah. Just, I'm snapping my finger like that.
Yeah. Awesome. All right, we got some more stuff coming up after the break. We got your mailbag. John Beaupre is going to come in and join us and talk to us about playing tournament PLO versus cash PLO, the differences there.
For that little tournament that's around the corner.
Yeah, that's been going on in Vegas. And then maybe a couple of hands from Ross's latest downswing, it sounds like. That's not a good thing, but we'll get to some Roscoe report as well after the break. You're listening to the 2+2 PokerCast, presented by the PokerStars VIP Club. More right after this.
Playing 50 big blinds deep with Annie's, the villain in the hand opens to 2.2x from the cutoff, and I defend my big blind with ace-free offsuit. The flop comes ace-6-9 with two clubs, and I check call a free big blind c-bet. The turn is a free, bringing a second flush draw and giving me two pairs. And once again I check call, this time for five big blinds. The river is a six of clubs, completing the flush and counterfeiting me as well. I check and he bets 11 big blinds. As it's close to the worst possible hand I can have at this point, and I have full house blockers, I turn it into a bluff and check raise all in.
Team Pro Online's Mickey Moment Mori Peterson is a supernova VIP. This is the 2 plus 2 PokerCast, presented by the PokerStars VIP Club.
What's up, guys? My name is John Beaupre, and I'm the founder and lead instructor of PLOQuickpro.com. Now, we're the only site that has an entire suite of PLO courses designed by myself, a WSOP champion, and three-time Supernova Elite PLO Crusher Alien Slayer. Over the past few years, we've successfully taught more than 1,000 players how to master the fundamentals, increase their win rate, and move up in stakes for good. So whether you're a small or micro stakes grinder trying to become a winner for the first time, or you're already a winning player looking to make more money and move up in stakes, and especially if you're a no-limit player looking to make the transition to PLO, we've got the videos, PDFs, and tutorials to help you plug leaks and look at the game in a new way. To learn the guaranteed fastest ways to master the fundamentals, increase your win rate, and move up in stakes for good, visit www.PLOQuickpro.com/pokercast to get your very own personalized PLO curriculum. Or even better, if you'd like to reach out to me personally, shoot me an email at john@PLOQuickpro.com and I'll help you find the best courses to fit your game. Good luck.
Hi guys, it's Mike from ProfessionalPoker.com and the 2 plus 2 store with some great news for our PokerStars players. You can now use your frequent player points to purchase gift cards available from ProfessionalPoker.com. These same cards will also work at the 2 plus 2 store. The gift cards come in increments of $25 and $50, and you can apply multiple gift cards per order. Now you can get the books, videos, and ebooks from all the major publishers using just your FPPs. So check out the gift card section of the PokerStars FPP store and pick up the poker training material you've had your eye on for a while at the 2 plus 2 store and ProfessionalPoker.com.
Attention everyone not named Alan Kessler. Have someone you would love to appear on the PokerCast? Have someone you don't want to hear again on the PokerCast? Head on over to the Suggest a Guest thread in the PokerCast forum at 2plus2.com and Adam will do his best to make you happy. P.S. Chainsaw, you can post too.
To the 2 plus 2 PokerCast presented by the PokerStars VIP Club. That's right there, Bob Cajun.
Tragically hip.
I know they're going to play that song on all their final gig tour across Canada.
That was my high school anthem. We would get
Bob Cajun?
We would get shit faced and sing that song a lot.
That night in Toronto. Yeah, it's a great song. Anyways, okay, let's move on. We're going to get to the PokerStars Invitational for PokerCast listeners right about now. Let's do that. We're going to give two passwords and two formats out. This is for the following two Sundays.
The idiot host last week forgot to do the Invitational. So, luckily the pro's back.
Yeah, like I haven't forgotten a million times in my career. June 5, this Sunday, it's a $1.10 buy-in. If you go to the PokerStars client, click on the private tab of the tournament's lobby, look for the PokerCast Invitational, you'll find it. The format for this Sunday at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern Is that right? No. 10 a.m. Eastern, 1 p.m. Pacific is either one of those two. I know for
time
sure.
Time would go fly backwards. So, yeah, if you live in the Eastern or Pacific time zones, you should show up at 10 and then show up again at 1. But show up at 10 first.
Play twice.
Especially if you're in the Pacific.
June 5th, head up, no limit, hold 'em. Heads up, no limit, hold 'em is going to be the format. The password's going to be pyramid. P-Y-R-A-M-I-D. I know how to spell. That's the latest promotions.
That's correct.
All lowercase.
That's good. All lowercase, that's all correct. One word, obviously. Heads up, no limit, hold 'em. June 12th, the following Sunday, is going to be progressive knockout six max. This is a fun format. Everybody loves this format. We haven't done it for a while. The password is 1 million spin and go. The number 1 million spin and go, all one word. There'll be some password gymnastics with that one, I'm sure. All right, so that's the invitational. Add it to your grind. Jump in there. We only got a couple of these left. Probably, four of these left with PokerStars. So try and
get your free money.
Try and bink the free 500 that they do add each week. All right, let's move on to, how about some 140 or less?
It's 140 characters, that's it. I love hashtags. I love all of them.
Terrence Chan
needs more than 140 characters to express himself.
140 or less.
Mr. Isaac Haxton at Ike Poker. Tune in to Poker Central tomorrow to watch six of the best poker players in the world and a blubbering man-child compete for $15 million. I wonder who he's talking about there. I think Ike is good buddies with King Dan Smith, who got into it with Phil. So he might have been coming to his buddy's defense there. A blubbering man-child. I thought that was pretty good.
Yeah. I mean, I think somebody, I can't forget who it was, but we shout outs to the person who said something like, I can't believe you would call Eric Seidel out like that.
Right. At Gordo MG, this is Mike Gordinsky. Had been planning on easing into Vegas cash games slowly for once this year. Obviously already playing 1,500, 3,000. Yeah. Which is awesome.
Well, I'm sure he's making money anyways.
Hopefully, yeah. At Lucas41, who's a listener to our show. At T-Champoker, hey Terrence, question for your show. I don't think you guys got to this one last week. I'll be in Vegas next week. Would like to bet on Euro 2016. Where's the best book to bet it?
I posted this in there because I don't have the slightest idea. I mean, I'm obviously not somebody who bets on soccer. But I will say that there are sports books who post their odds online. I've been trying to find, I think like maybe Vegas Insider. VegasInsider.com might post their odds on signups, but obviously you want the best value for whatever country you're going to be betting at. So I kind of wanted to throw this one out there to the PokerCast community to see if there was an answer out there.
I'm sure if you just Google it, you can find the different casinos' odds. Usually you can find like Caesars and Venetian and all the bigger ones. I know people like Palace Station Sportsbook for some reason.
So Ross is now our go-to sports betting question guy.
Yeah, I mean, I just watched the best of it. I recommend that movie to anyone. Watch that documentary, The Best of It. You can get it on iTunes. It is it's quite a watch.
Yeah.
I did find when I was sort of searching myself, pregame.com, which I think Jess Wellman was the one who sent me the site because I wanted a very similar question when I wanted to bet UFC live. They've got a bunch of odds for all of the brick and mortar sports books in Vegas. So you will probably be able to find them on pregame.com. But if anybody out there knows who's given the best odds on Euro or, you know, betting limits and that kind of stuff, go on over to the forums, pokercast.2plus2.com, post in the show thread, help out Lucas41 figure out where to get the best value for his Euro 2016 dollar.
So I know you don't know this, T, but Jess used to work at Pregame. She might still. Pregame is a tout site. They're a bunch of scammers who sell their.
But they just list the odds. So
yeah, no, for sure. But we're driving traffic to a place that if somebody wandered off and bought picks from some scammer, I'd feel bad. Right. So I just wanted to say
they'll do that. Just look at the odds and then close the website.
But there's other places you can go. You can go to Don Best. There's aggregators out there that you can go find. Just Google them. You'll find them. I will say that you're probably not going to find a good line in Vegas in live. you know, you're going to find stuff better offshore if you're...
Yeah, the internet is usually the answer to these things.
Yeah. If you're not from the USA and you can actually, you know, bet where you should be able to bet, there's definitely reputable places out there where you're going to find better lines. So go out there and line shop for sure. At $3 bankroll. So I wanted to actually just give a mention to this Twitter handle. This is one of the listeners to our show, at $3, the number three, $3 bankroll with one L. I guess he ran out of characters there. This is a listener who wandered into his Bovada account one night and found that he had $3.43 in there. And he started playing $5 no limit. And he's run it up to $340. And he posts hands on his Twitter account. His goal is to get to the World Series of Poker next year with a bunch of money and play a bunch of tournaments from this $3.43 that he's built it up from. He posts a bunch of hands. So if you're interested in strategy discussion from sort of lower limit games at the moment, maybe he's going to move up in stakes, give that Twitter handle a follow, at three, the number $3 bankroll. See if that might interest you at all. Why don't we get into the mailbag?
And now.
That right there is the mail. Now let's talk about the mail. Can we talk about the mail, please, Mac? I'm dying to talk about the mail with you all day, okay?
Mailbag. Email number
one. D. Ross writes, "Hey guys, thanks for keeping my commute to work to New York City entertaining. Just listened to the episode where you guys asked for situations on how much it would take for someone to do something. I posed this question to people before and I thought I'd send it in. Say you guys had a 50-50 chance of either dying or getting $1 billion tax-free. Would you do it? For less, for more, or wouldn't take the chance? Just hit the Lincoln Tunnel almost at work. Take care." Yeah, I'm not doing anything even remotely close to this for $1 billion.
Life is worth a lot. Life is worth a lot.
Yeah.
It's worth more than anything financial. I mean, because you don't get to spend money when you're dead. That's kind of obvious, but, I like my life, pretty happy. I guess sort of the only way that this is reasonable is like if you're just absolutely buried in debt and you're considering suicide because of it. But please just call the suicide hotline and
just declare bankruptcy.
Sort all that stuff out, and just sort bankruptcy or figure something out. Don't take coin. Don't play Russian roulette.
Is there a number that I would play? That I would play Russian roulette for $1 billion? I don't even know that there really is. Like.
I think I would do $1 billion if I had like a 1 in 1,000 chance of dying.
Yeah, I think what happens when you have kids is you totally change. This totally changes for you. If before I had kids, I'd be like, yeah, Ross, I could see that. But now, there's no chance.
I don't have kids. I'm still not doing it. I mean, it's not even close. Like, it doesn't matter. 1 billion, 1 trillion, whatever. Doesn't.
Yeah.
I like how he says tax free though. Because you'd be worried. It's like, well, shoot, after taxes, I'm only going to get $565 million out of this. So that's clearly not worth it.
Email number two.
Adam writes, years ago, I used to listen to Jim Rome. He has a rule about what he calls personal appearance smack, and it is banned on his show. Well, this policy is solid, and it's LCD to be critical of others' appearances, a la Donald Trump. I don't know what LCD means.
Lowest common denominator.
Oh, it's okay. It has to be okay in some situations. In essence, there has to be an exception to the rule. After spending hours looking at Phil Hellmuth's nose in high definition, I propose he is the exception. That mole in the butt crack of his nose is so tilting, and that's all I can focus on. I think it's growing, too. Number one, if we were to name it, what would we name it? And two, does keeping it have a strategic purpose? Hearing Terrence host last week was awesome. Lately, the show has been more inconsistent. When I get sick, I usually have to go to work. The gesture meant more than the scratchy voice detracted much, much more. Thanks. Wow, has it been
inconsistent? That warms my heart at night.
Has it been inconsistent? I don't feel like we've been inconsistent.
It warms my feelings at night.
Yeah, it does. I mean, I did feel like, you know, it would have been rough to skip last week. So, luckily I managed to get the show done out of the way before I got full blown sick, because I would have That wouldn't have been fun at all.
Yeah, I feel kind of bad. Somebody pointed out that I should have done more of the reading, and I kind of agree with them.
Oh, right.
I mean, that's what are you going to do? I mean, I survived. I made it through. Not too much damage done. With respect to Helmuth's nose, I never even thought about that, but I mean, I guess this is probably happening. I'm guessing this email was sent sometime after the Super High Roller Bowl started appearing on TV, and so Adam might have like a big screen TV in his house, and he's got like a 72-inch TV with HD. Making fun of people because of their physical appearance, never okay. Making fun of people who bring it upon themselves, that's always fun, right?
So Phil brings it on himself?
Maybe just a little.
He was wearing a Golden State Warriors jersey on the telecast, and
I think it was his son's. Medium.
Yeah, he's a big dude, and he was wearing it was like a medium. He was kind of bulging out of it.
You're wearing a medium, Phil. Yeah, you're not.
And he's rocking gold sneakers as well.
Oh my lord! Let's move on.
Email number
3.
Scott from Corona writes, "Hey Adam, Terrence, and Ross. My name is Scott from Corona, California, 8,237 kilometers from Kells. I love he's from California, and he made it in kilometers. Attaboy. And we've been listening to MJ's farewell episode. Wow, it's a couple years old. I absolutely love the show and wanted to toss a question into the mailbag. I was playing 5-5 PLO with a $10 rock that immediately posts on the next hand with action preflop starting to the left of the rock. A player got mad when he offered to run the board twice, and a player, who I assumed ran it twice before, declined. Discussion continued later from the angry player that if you run it twice, you do it every time. Do you believe that the etiquette of running it twice matches chopping the blinds, where if you do it once, you do it every time? My personal rule is a function of stack depth. If we're in +1K each, I'm game running it twice. Less than that once is good. I like to reduce variance, but I've got to draw the line somewhere. I've been at 2-3 PLO table where a short buy of $60 shoves and asked to run it twice when there's a $7 California drop. Anyways, love you guys. Ross, good luck on your PLO ladder climb. I'm learning a lot from the Ross report. Terrence, congrats on your scoop performance. And Adam, good job on the slide whistle. Finally, a favorite thing. Get a chance to grab a Salty Scott Wee Heavy Ale from Latitude 49 Brewing in Vancouver. Might be the best thing you've ever put in your mouth. Cheers, Mike. Cheers, Scott, who we've said was twice from Corona, California.
Some of the best things that I've ever put in my mouth.
But yeah, it's not gonna. Beer is never the best thing that you've ever put in your mouth. Anyways,
it beats used dental floss. So
it does. Yeah. As far as running it twice goes, I don't think it's this. I wouldn't say it's the same as the blinds. It's sort of an etiquette thing with blinds. If you're gonna chop, if you're not, and don't be upset either way.
I think it's totally, totally different. And the reason is because, you know, people who do the thing of, okay, I'm going to chop this hand, not the other hand, they tend to do it when they have like a big hand, right? So they'll look, you know, they'll look down, they'll have the 7-3 offsuit and like, okay, let's chop the blinds. And then they have aces next time and now they don't. It's obviously very different when you're talking about running the board twice because it's just like, well, whatever, I have 27%
equity.
It doesn't matter. I have 27%. I have 80%. It really doesn't matter whether you're running it once or twice. So I think, I think that Scott, has it right. You know, it's a function of stack size, the effective size of the pot. If the pot seems really big for you, then run it twice. If it doesn't, if it's not, then, I mean, you could still run it twice when it's a small pot. It doesn't hurt anybody. It just kind of wastes a little bit of time.
Well,
there's not any issue with that.
I've heard Lyman talk about this, and it actually makes sense that in California, where there is such a high drop rake, you might want to run it twice more because you effectively get a second free hand of poker because they don't rake, you know, twice for the running it twice.
But you don't really. I mean, that to me doesn't make a lot of sense because you're not getting the reason why you want to play more hands and get free poker is so that you can make your edge bigger, you know, over time. That's why you would want free hands, but you don't make your edge bigger when you run it twice.
Yeah.
So I'm not really sure I follow that logic.
Oh, okay.
Unless I'm missing something, I don't get that.
Yeah. It's sort of.
But certainly I don't think you should ever be upset or anybody should ever be upset if they choose to run it twice on one situation and not to run it twice in another situation. I think that it's perfectly acceptable etiquette. It might not make you some friends sometimes, but hey, we're not always here to make friends. We're just here to play poker and make money.
Email number 004.
Mike writes, Adam Ross, TC. Hello from Telford, England, 252 miles from Kells. Although Google Maps reckons that I can cut that down to 228 if I walk rather than drive. So that's comforting, at least. I'm due to make my first trip out to Vegas this year with my fiance. My question is, and apologies if it's been covered before, which daily poker tournament should I make a point of trying to play? Probably looking at the Area 125, but can probably fit in one or two more at a similar low buy-in. Which rooms are worth hitting up and why? Keep up the awesome work. Yeah, I think we did talk about it. The deep stacks are going to be big fields if you're looking to, you know, bank a big payoff for a small buy-in, but you're going to pay a bunch of juice. I think the deep stack is probably your play there. You can head over to the Aria, play in the daily, or some of the smaller, you know, casinos, Planet Hollywood and such, that do daily tournaments during the series. It might be, you know, the way to go. But I think if I'm you and I'm going there for fun, I'm going to play a couple 125s. I think I'm going to play some deep stacks, T.
Yeah, I mean, maybe it's reasonable. I mean, those are going to be soft fields. I mean, I can't say for sure. Venetian's probably kind of out of your price range for this, even if you don't have a bias against Sheldon, but most of the Venetian buy-ins are bigger. I'm looking at, the link that Kev Math dropped on us. If you haven't listened to that show 3 weeks ago, where it was when we had Kev Math on. You definitely have to at least listen to that interview, but check out, bit.ly/WSOP2016, and that's got the full rundown of every, if it's cards being played on felt in poker, that spreadsheet will have it. But I think we covered it mostly. Planet Hollywood, Aria, the Win will have some stuff, although again, that's some higher buy-in stuff as well. Golden Nugget downtown and maybe some Binions as well. In terms of like personal preference for poker rooms, I'm not sure, you know, obviously the Aria is going to be much more comfortable than the Rio. So, but it depends what you're sort of maximizing for, right? Are we maximizing for value? Are we maximizing for experience? You know, that kind of thing. I think the Aria is a super nice poker room and the Rio's not.
Yeah. So that, if you want to find that spreadsheet Terrence is talking about, it's in the show thread for the show with Kev Math.
Right.
But, one thing that popped into mind was, actually, the Planet Hollywood series that ran last year had really good structures and low buy-ins. So I believe that's running again this year. And it's a Caesars property. You get your World Series of Poker card and you go sign in there. And they had some 200-300 buy-ins with hour long levels. So check that out. That's probably the best structure.
We got some more emails, but I think we'll save those for next week. We're going to bring in Mr. John Beauprez from PLOQuickpro.com now. And we're going to talk about, we've got the World Series of Poker coming up. We're going to talk about the differences in PLO between cash and tournament play. John, welcome back to the show.
Hey, what's up, guys? Good to be here.
Glad to have you, sir. You're heading to Vegas. Give us your Vegas plans.
You know, this year I'm going to focus on cash games, but I am going to play all of the PLO events. I don't really plan on playing a lot of no limit MTTs unless I guess I'm feeling it, but I think the only NL MTT I'm playing is the main event, but I plan on playing, you know, next weekend there's like a PLO reentry, like a 565, and then on Monday there's like a 1K PLO. There's also like a half PLO, half, I think it's like half no limit, half PLO 1500 that I was looking at playing. And then the 10K PLO and the 25K PLO, and then also the 3K PLO 6 max. So just a lot of PLO on the schedule, both in cash and tournaments.
Sounds like it. I want to talk about those PLO tournaments in a second, but first you mentioned focusing on cash at the World Series. What's your take on sort of, I know the games haven't started yet, so you're not 100% sure this year, but over the last few years, what's the PLO cash games like? How big do you play? How do you find the games? Are they getting tougher? Are they getting better? What's your take there?
I think that the, like, 50, I would say 25, 50 plus is kind of hit or miss in general. Sometimes they can be great. You know, last year I thought 25, 50 plus wasn't that great. But, you know, I think that the, like, 5, 10 and the 10, 20 games are typically really good. If anything, it's good action. I mean, it just depends what you're looking for. But, you know, the quarter 50 plus is kind of hit or miss. I mean, I find that, like, you know, it's rare where you're going to find a table that's just unbelievable. At least, like, you know, a third or half of the table is going to be very, very, very good players. But you might find a few guys who are kind of going out. But I think that where the sweet spot is typically, like, the 5-10 and the 10-20.
Are those 25-50 games typically at the Rio? Or are they at Bellagio? What's the spread around town with those games?
I mean, I would say mostly Aria, Bellagio, and Rio. That's pretty much where we see them. I mean, and, you know, you have to always remember that they're one level bigger. So, like, if it says 10 and a quarter, it usually plays like a 25-50. You know, if it says 5-10, it usually plays like a 10-20. And if it says 25-50, it usually plays like a 50-100.
And that's just because of the depths of the stacks. Is that what mostly is, or is it because of the straddles, or what?
A lot of straddles.
Yeah, it's a lot of it has to do with the straddles. I mean, it's pretty rare where you're playing a game and it really is a 5-10 where there's no straddling. So, and that's part of what makes PLO so attractive. I think a lot of the no limit guys that kind of get big eyes when they're walking past the PLO table and they see all of these big pots going down. And, you know, it says 5-10 PLO, but there's people with, like, 10 to 20K stacks. We don't really see that in No Limit. And so I think that's kind of what draws PLO into the first place, at least when people first start. When people first come to me and they're coming from No Limit, that's usually the biggest reason why, is they say, you know, I constantly am seeing two reasons. They say there's more action in the PLO games, and they also say that they see a lot of bad No Limit regs doing really well at PLO, and they want to know how to do it too. So I think that, you know, it's funny to see how PLO has really progressed over the years. When I first started coming to the World Series in, like, I don't know, 2007, 2008, you know, there was, like, one or two tables of, like, 5-10 and a quarter. And now it's pretty easy to find, like, 4 to 6 tables anywhere around town, and especially where you've seen a huge increase is in the 5-5 tables. Like, it's amazing how many 5-5 PLO tables run, particularly at the Rio. I mean, there'll be, like, sometimes there's, like, 6 to 8 tables of 5-5 PLO, which is incredible. And they're big games, actually.
Yeah, the 5-5, I at the very end of our Vegas trip last year, I hopped into the 5-5 PLO. I think our flight left in, like, 6 hours, and I sat down, and it was 5-5. But the button straddle was 25.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's incredible. You'll see, like, it's not uncommon to see 10K pots at 5-5 PLO. You know? it's unreal. So
they're gambling.
Yeah, people are gambling, and the straddles get big, and people get stuck, and all hell breaks loose.
Okay, let's talk about tournaments, John, and the difference between PLO cash and PLO tournaments. You know, we talk a lot about PLO. The hand ranges run close, or the hand equities run close. But, you know, you've got to figure out where in a tournament that you want to, you know, take your close equity hand up against another close equity hand. So what's your sort of, what are some of the things that you talk about when somebody comes up to you and says, hey, what are the differences between cash and tournament PLO?
Yeah, well, I think the more important difference, perhaps, is to compare no-limit tournaments to PLO tournaments, because I think that more people are familiar with no-limit tournaments, right? So I think it's the first and biggest adjustment is that there's no annies. People forget about that, right?
Right.
No-limit, it's like a common strategy where you have to develop, like, good re-stealing ranges and re-shoving ranges and you know, how to play, like, a 6 big blind stack. And really, like, how people structure those strategies is based off of the fact that there's a lot of dead money out there pre-flop. And in PLO, it's a little different because there's no ante, so there's actually not a lot of incentive to be really getting out of line pre. And you can, even when you're, you know, 10 big blinds in a PLO tournament, in my opinion, is a lot more than in, like, a no-limit tournament because there is no antes and that you don't get chewed up as much when the blinds go around. So, in general, like, I think that for PLO tournaments, tight is right, and just because people in general don't understand PLO strategy as well, you can get away with just playing tight and waiting for other people to make grave mistakes for big pots.
What would be one of those big mistakes, other than playing a little bit too loose, but when you see people kind of punting it off in PLO tournaments, is it mostly, playing a hand pre-flop that they shouldn't, or is it just a poor decision post-flop?
I would say it's more likely to be a poor decision post-flop. It's like maybe on a very wet board, on like a, let's say it's like a 10-6-5 two-tone board, people overplaying two pair or playing, putting in too much money with a naked set or something like that, and just not really understanding the equities quite as much, I would say, are some of the bigger mistakes that you see. And I would say, I mean, for me personally, in the past, I really haven't played PLO tournaments very well. I think that I've spent more time this year really kind of talking to other good players and figuring out what more optimal PLO tournament strategy is. But I think that, like, in the past, I've really just tried to treat it like a cash game, and that just doesn't work. One of the things that I've actually done this year to really prepare more for the PLO tournaments is I've rewatched all of the final tables from the PLO World Series events last year, which was pretty cool because I wanted to get a good idea of really what the guys who are at the top of their game do, like the Jason Mercier and what Anthony Zeno did last year. He had a very good series. And you really noticed that a lot of them, yeah, they shift gears well and they're paying attention to the various bubbles in the tournament, but they really do play pretty tight overall. And they make some very big folds pre-flop that you would never make in a cash game. You know what I'm saying? So I think that it kind of confirmed a lot of my beliefs about the overall approach to PLO tournaments.
I did something. It's funny that you said you went back and watched World Series replays. One of my favorite things to do in the last week or so is watch the scoop replays, which, obviously you've got some super high stakes PLO tournaments in that, and you've got some really elite players in that. And I definitely watched that. One thing that was, of course, interesting is because the stack sizes are much smaller, people are often put to a decision about getting it in light on a flop. You talked a bit earlier about how being 10 big blinds, 12 big blinds deep is certainly not as critical of PLO as it is in No Limit, but you get into some really awkward spots where, it was a raised pot pre-flop and it's somebody's bet and it's close to being an all-in situation right on the flop, and the guy is sort of sitting there with, like, he's got like middle pair and a gut shot and a three flush, and these are situations in a cash game that are almost easier to navigate because you have more money, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that you value your tournament life a lot, and there's just that's one of the fun things that really is like about tournaments that I like. But yeah, I also feel like in tournaments you have to be in tournament mode, because I think in order to be successful tournaments, it requires a lot of patience. And in the past, I haven't done very well in World Series tournaments, partially because I'm always like, if I bust this, I'm going to go play a cash game. And, I'm just going to try to run up a stack and then see what happens. And I don't think that that's really the best mind frame for playing tournaments. Like, now this year, I'm like, I'm kind of spacing it out where, like, for example, the first time I go out, I'm only going out for 4 days. I'm kind of treating it like, all right, well, I'm only here, like, this is like, I'm treating it like it's my last tournament, so I'm trying to take it more seriously, whereas, like, in the past, I've been out there all summer, and I've kind of sort of, I feel like I've just thrown away a lot of, honestly, entries where I just was like, if I bust, I'm going to play cash. And I don't really want that attitude. Like, if I'm going to play a tournament, I'm going to take it seriously.
So how do you, strategically handle some of those spots where you could be playing a pot for your life, but you don't really have very much? Like I said, a pair and a bad gut shot, these kind of scenarios, because, even watching a lot of the best players in the world play, it seems, a lot of them will err towards the side of the tight lay down, and some of them will be like, well, shit, I guess I have to get it in with this because I'm too short. How do you sort of decide on that thing? Obviously it goes to the subtlety of playing poker well, but what's your general thought on that?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think that in any poker decision, what's more important than anything is to kind of trust your instincts. Usually I found that your first instinct in a hand is normally the right one. So it's important to pay attention to your first instincts. But the second thing that I noticed that all of the best players do well is they really, especially like, I watch just final tables, and the final table I think has a very particular dynamic as opposed to other stages of the tournament. There's like heavier ICM implications and more leverage points and stuff like that. So, but you can tell they really pay attention to move ups. They really pay attention to who has position on them, and I think that whether or not you want to gamble in the spot that you're talking about where you have some kind of medium strength hand depends a lot on how, like, when the next move up is, what stage of the tournament it is, and if you have if you make a tight fold, if you have a chance to lean on some other players to gain some chips and like still be able to run up, like, you know, increase your stack later in the tournament. I think that's like in a lot of close tournament decisions is usually what it comes down to. Like, am I drawing slim in other ways to accumulate chips? Like, do I have to gamble for chips now, or can I actually realistically wait later on to find better spots to accumulate chips? If you can, then maybe you should gamble to try to get chips now and risk your tournament life. But if you can, then you should typically like make a tight fold.
John, I want to ask you about post-flop bet sizing in tournaments versus cash games. You know, there's different things that come into play when you're making a bet, if you're in position, out of position, your hand strength, etc. What's your sort of take on the differences between cash and tourneys there?
Well, especially in the later stages of tournaments, effective stacks are a lot smaller. So you can make, you know, typically it's like conventional or like, conventional wisdom that, like, especially on wetter boards, in cash games, you use bigger sizing. Like, a lot of times you see people potting the flop with a mixture of made hands and good draws and maybe even bluffs sometimes. So, you know, like the board that I mentioned earlier, if it's 10-6-5 with a flush draw, or maybe like Jack 10-6 with a flush draw, you're going to see people potting it here with a mixture of two pair plus and maybe like a pair and a gut shot and a nut flush draw and just a variety of different things, right? In tournaments, like, since effective stacks are so much lower, even on those very wet boards, you'll see smaller bet sizings. And that's because people can leverage more even with smaller sizings. They, you know, when you're playing a cash game and people are 100 big blinds or more deep, you can't really leverage someone's stack with a pot size bet on the flop. But in a tournament, when, you know, most effective stacks are between 15 big blinds and 25 big blinds, you really can, like, use these smaller sizings even on very wet boards.
Fair enough. Thanks so much. Anybody else wants to find out some more about, do you have some tourney PLO stuff over PLO QuickPro?
Yeah, we have something called Tournament Time that I give away for free now, but which I charged for at one time, that you can check out on our site. And of course, you can always just email me if you have any tourney questions. Of course, john@PLOQuickPro.com. I'm happy to give anybody any advice I can offer.
Fantastic. Thanks, John. Really appreciate your time, and good luck at the World Series. Hope to see you bink one of those PLO events.
Hey, of course, man. Next time we do, I'm on the show. Hopefully we're talking about a big one.
That's right. All right. Thanks, John.
Hopefully it's mine.
Yes, please. That'd be amazing.
Thanks.
All right,
so much,
guys.
John.
Take care. Thanks. Appreciate it.
I think that's going to wrap it up, guys. When's the next all-in or knockout?
Boy, putting us on the spot like that one. I'm working on the script. I'm writing it up. And then, you know, the next one's a tough one. Like I said, I think I've said before, because, you know, we're getting into the actual fight. So there's a lot of ways that we can take it. And one of the tough things is like, we've got the fight, which is an essentially visual experience, and we're going to have to try to make that into an audio experience. And I'm really kind of curious about, you know, whether we succeed or that. But Ross and I are going to grind away and communicate on it. And you know, we've got extra motivated this week because we got a couple extra donations. So that was really, really nice. And so we definitely feel the urge to put some stuff out there. But of course, I'm driving to Vegas, and Ross is off to see the glittering lights of the Big Apple.
Yeah.
To New York City.
Yeah, I go tonight see my cousin. I think I've mentioned on the show before that I have a cousin that works at Vice, so I'm apparently going to be in the Vice offices this week.
Nice. I was going to say, are you going to be like snorting cocaine and jumping out of helicopters and like shooting guns and like, you know, having what else happens?
Going to some like nuclear reacted monkey islands.
Exactly.
Yeah, with sniper rifles.
That's what the real reason you're going to New York.
To hunt mutant animals, yeah. I'll try and stick on the poker cast while I do my Vice documentary. But I wanted to echo that sentiment because I do want to get another episode out. It's a little bit hard when we're in different cities, but we're definitely going to work hard on doing it. And I look forward to getting it out there.
Cool. Say hi to Shane Smith and some thank yous. We got to thank Mr. Doug Polk for joining us in the second segment. He's at the World Series. Thanks to Matthew Hilger from the Isle of Man, and thank you to John Beaupre for joining us. Thank you guys, Terrence from Seattle, and Roscoe from the airport, I guess, to hop on a plane. And to you for listening to the show each week. Thanks so much. Please come visit us at our forum. We beg of you. It's the only form of feedback we get other than the email, so head on over and let us know how we're doing.
Yeah.
We will talk to you next week. Can't thank you guys enough for the 8 wonderful years you've been our sponsor. Did we lose Matthew?
I thought it was me for a second. It's, for once, it wasn't me. Thank you. Maybe that was it. Maybe that he just dropped the mic. This is how it ends.
Oh, Jesus.
That's this awesome. Is how the sponsorship ends. You're like, screw you guys.
This is the best outtake ever.
That was great.
This was not planned, I promise.
There he is.
Okay.
Matthew, did you hear what I said?
I did not. My internet literally went out, I think, right at when you were about to start.
Oh, okay.
Here. So I'll start again. Ross, you ready to go?
Yeah, we're still going here. Let me make a note. Yeah, you just go ahead or say what you were going to say again.
Okay.
Thanks for joining us. The 2+2 Pokercast has been presented to you by the Poker.